This week on the Dissect That Film podcast, six people sit down to talk about 20 years of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. Come on in and let's have some fun.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to Dissect That Film, where we dissect the good, the bad, and the ugly of your favorite films and film franchises. I am your host, Brett Parker. Joining me, as always, is my wonderful co-host, Dan and Angela of DNA Gaming.
Woo!
Sorry.
Hello.
And joining us are the three men behind the wonderful podcast, Give Me Back My Action / Horror. We have Charlie, Nate, and Pete. Welcome in, gentlemen.
What's going on?
I thought you said you were going to screw up that intro. That was very well done.
I'll well, you know. Yeah, it's because you all are here. I had an audience. Okay, I couldn't fuck up. I'm on that stage. I'm on that stage. The lights are on me. Yeah, I can't fuck up that intro.
You perform well under pressure. Huh?
Yes, it's just when Dan and Angela here, they get me all hot and bothered, and I don't know what to do.
They make fun of him.
Yes, they laugh at me. And
hey, you laugh at us.
But I always make shit going on in the background. I'll be doing dumb stuff just to throw him off sometimes.
When I'm introducing stuff and you're like staring at me, like stop looking at me.
And this is also what we do. We just go on side tangents that go on for 5 or more minutes each.
It happens, quest. Man. That's what podcast is all.
Yes, yes.
Side quest. I like that, Nate. That's good.
I played softball growing up. You can't expect me to not be out in left field.
That's true.
Oh, not a bump.
Hey, well, welcome in, gentlemen. It is an absolute honor to have you on. As I've said it many times before we even started the episode, big fan of your show.
Thank you.
I don't even know how I got into your show. I think we just became Instagram friends. I hopped into one of your episodes and I've been hooked ever since. And as it's been with a lot of podcasts, then I get introduced to other awesome podcasts that I have to kind of, you know, as I mentioned before, I got into Spoils of Horror because of you guys. Great podcast. You've been on a podcast, one of our friends, Dustin from Flicks and Friends. We're good friends with him, and you were on the Departed episode, which was fucking amazing.
Ah, you were cop.
So, yeah, we've kind of known of each other for quite a while, and it's
we've been playing this dancing game around
like,
one another.
When are we gonna get on each other's shows?
I hope they ask me out first.
I'm pretty
will
sure
they won't they?
Yeah. I think it was one of those things.
And he's got his earbuds in. It's like, oh, that's where I found you guys. After never mind.
And that's drunk Pete, everyone. Thank you.
This is super tired Pete, because I was at Rocky Horror Picture Show last night, which was marvelous. And jealous. I know it's like been 24 hours later, but I've got this hangover from last night. It's a good time.
So you and I are both nursing a hangover today.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the hair of the dog.
And the best part is it's 9 p.m. on a Sunday and we're both feeling like shit.
What other way to feel? What better way to feel?
It's what
should
Sundays
be 9 a.m.
getting over what you did on Saturday. Over the stupid shit you did on Saturday.
Ooh, I'm sober and don't remember.
But yeah, but it was
Saturday.
It was one of those moments where I finally reached out to, I think it was Charlie, and I was like, hey, you guys want to come on the show? And he's like, we've been waiting. And I was like, yes. You know, and I feel like, bad at the start. And yeah, I know. Yeah. It's just, you know, I was nervous. I was nervous.
You guys are big Godzilla fans. Why did you make us watch this movie?
Well, let's get to that, Pete. Let's get to that. So,
such a wait to tell us how you feel.
You know what? It's no holds barred here. It's no holds barred. But as you know, this is our Spooktober favorite series, where each week, except for our Freddy vs. Jason episode, we pick a movie to cover that kind of fits in, you know, Halloween, you know, spooky times. You know, we cover horror all the time, but this is the time of year where each of us gets to pick our own movie. We already covered Angela's pick, which was Trick or Treat back the 2007 film. Then we covered Dan's pick, Rodan, from 1957.
Yes!
And now we're here. We're here covering the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2003, which is my pick. And let me tell you why I picked it, because this was my first Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. You know, I'm not, you know, ashamed to say it. And it's my favorite Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. It's a movie I watched.
You hear the crickets in the background?
Yeah, I just
that
see
was really weird.
For everyone watching the video, for everyone who's just listening, you know, just audio listeners, Pete is in pain. He is contemplating why he came on the show.
The more we talk about this, the more he's just going to disappear.
I have my friend here.
Of all the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies throughout my life, this is the one I've seen the most. You know, this is the first one I saw. This is, I don't know. I liked the aesthetics of it. I liked the performance of Leatherface in this. I liked his brute. You know, he was more of a brute. He was scary to me. And yeah, it's just mostly, you know, and I got this, I remember buying this awesome special edition DVD that literally I don't have them anymore. I'm kind of sad, but it came when it rolls out, it's a giant chainsaw.
So that is pretty cool.
I remember that.
And
one.
Down here
that's
in this pouch good. Used to be crime scene photos. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where they went,
but the joys of movie. Aww.
Yes. And I used to watch this movie all the time. I loved it. And to be honest, you know, as the person who picked this movie, I can share with you what I feel about it. After watching this the latest time, I still love this movie.
You like what you like, man.
I do. So let's go around the room and just talk about for the rest of the cast here. Let's talk about our history with this movie. And if you don't have a history of this movie, we'll just move on. So let's start with our, or past, yes. So let's start with our guests, and whoever wants to go, just start talking.
I mean, let's have Pete bring the mood down first.
Yeah.
We'll lift everything up afterwards. So Pete, why don't you give everybody your first.
I think the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre I saw was the second one. I had a buddy in high school who was one of the few folks in town that had cable. So we would go over there on Saturday nights or something and stay up way too late, getting hopped up on Jolt Cola, and we would watch Hellraiser and TCM and the Freddy and Jason movies, all that good stuff. And I think I saw two first, and I was disturbed that I was laughing through some of it. It was very strange. I don't think it was a while before I saw the OG, the original, and might have been early in college when I had rented that, and it legitimately scared me. It was quite good and dirty, and you could smell that movie. It was gross. When this one came out, I wasn't thrilled because, well, I'm not thrilled about most remakes. They're just usually not very good. And I watched this, and it was like it had a lot of good beats to it, but it fell short of the first one. So I think this is the second time I watched it was for this show. So that's what I got. How about you, Nate?
Let's see. Watching this yesterday was the first time I have seen this since 2003. Honestly, I remember watching this when it came out. I didn't go see it in theaters. I was 15 when this one came out. And me and a buddy rented it, and I remember just being pissed off because there was so much blood. And I was like, this isn't the original, and just like being an angsty teenager. So when we got the opportunity to cover this, I'd been wanting to revisit it for a minute because of how bad the 2022 one was.
Oh, yeah.
And I was just like, well, maybe the remake's better than this. Like, I got to revisit this. And then I just have not watched that in forever. So I was like, I'm curious to see if angsty teenage Nate is still going to hate this movie or not. And I will leave that surprise for later. So, yeah, I've only seen this movie twice now. What about you, Charlie?
I saw this in theaters. This was the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre I got to see in theaters. I was excited for it because, hot take, the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre bores me. It's
not because Charlie's dumb and doesn't like horror movies, so that's the problem right there.
Charlie likes plenty of horror movies, but you know,
I don't like classics.
Ooh, drop like that clowns.
That's the other C word. But no, this one I actually, in you know, was looking forward to the gore, which it definitely delivered on. That is the biggest thing I've always remembered about this one. I actually owned that same DVD that you had in the background, traded in at someplace. You know, Nate knows the buybacks here in Columbus. Pete probably remembers them too. You know, traded those in when streaming took off, because I'm like, I'm never going to need physical again, and got rid of them. I regret it because it was cool. It was a giant freaking chainsaw. But I've watched this movie, I don't know, 5 or 6 times, I think. Been a while till this episode of, you know, wanting to cover it. And again, I'll play along with the, we'll hold my, you know, how I feel about this movie now till the end of the episode. But
One thing about that DVD too, when that was released, I want to say that's when they re-released the original one on DVD with its first restoration. It came with the package that was hamburger meat.
Yes.
As well.
Yes. Yes.
I remember that one.
That's one I regret not getting.
Mm-hmm. That was a cool one. Yeah, it was weird. That was that time we were getting those cool ones, you know, like the Army of Darkness one with the leather bound Necronomicon and stuff like that. It was like, let's make the cases feel like something you don't want to touch. That's pretty much how that worked.
What they were in on for.
Exactly. But yeah.
All right. Yeah. Angela, Dan.
No, you go.
Oh,
you
I
go
get
first.
To go. Okay.
Cause I have to bring it all. I have to bring it all to.
Okay.
Bring it around town. Bring it.
I will actually mirror Parker. This is actually my first Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie as well. For the guys here are not familiar, man, you've listened to the show a few times, surely, but I did not grow up watching horror movies. It just wasn't how it was with me growing up. But anyway, not going to regurgitate that spiel. But I actually was at my cousin's. I used to hang out with my eldest cousin and his girlfriend, and they worked at Walmart, and we'd go out. What was it? I don't remember what the rotation was. It was either Monday going into Tuesday or Tuesday going to Wednesday. They'd put all the horror movies or the new movies out.
It was Monday going into Tuesday. I used to work in the electronics department.
Thank you.
At a Walmart.
And we'd go out there at midnight and we'd get movies and snacks and just watch shit.
God, I miss those days.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I wasn't in school or nothing at the time, so I wasn't doing anything. So I was like, fuck it. So we used to go, and then they brought this home. It was my first, or to their house. And that's where I'd hang out. We watched it. First time I'd seen it. And that's about the biggest experience. I actually didn't see the original one until much later. Did we talk about it on the show? Did we cover the original one?
No, we've only done a fresh cut on the 2022.
The cancel culture one. That's right. Yeah. Anyway, that's about the extent of it. Like, I just remember watching. I've seen it a few times since then. So.
When did we watch this?
Today? Yeah, 2 days ago.
That was my first time watching this.
Oh, wow.
All right.
I know.
The history, it's thick, it's full.
I know. 2 days worth of history.
This is a lot of the movies we've covered on this show. Angela has gone in for the first time. So it's nice. And I like it.
That's cool. I didn't get to watch a lot of these. Like, they grew up different than I did. I grew up in a very religious household. So I didn't get to watch a lot of anything until probably midway through high school. I snuck around and watched stuff that I wasn't supposed to watch.
So instead of sneaking around doing drugs, it was sneaking around watching horror movies
and listening to music that I knew I wasn't supposed to be watching.
That's Satan's. Not Creed.
My
Satan's hymns.
My first rated R movie that I got to watch was with my brother and sister-in-law, and it was Driver, and I got to watch that in theater.
Driver.
And it
like
was
a PS1
or Ryan Gosling movie, Drive.
Something like that. It was a rated R movie. It was a race car. It was a race car movie. It could have been Driven, but
Driven with Sylvester Stallone.
Telling my mom that I had watched that movie, you thought it was the end of the world.
It was the end of the world.
Like, nothing in that movie at all.
But it was the fact that it was a rated R movie.
Ooh, mom.
This is just funny to me because our daughter's like, you know, we've been watching Friday the 13th. I was like, Friday the 13th, part 6. And she's like, yeah, my daughter's 7.
Nice. So, like, that's the way it should be, because that's how we all were growing up.
Yeah, see, like, that's what my cousins were. And I was just like, it's, of course, that's not my favorite Friday the 13th, but anyway, but there's really no nudity. That's really my only big concern about it. But like, she's watched with us.
Like, that, anyway, it's a perfect Friday the 13th movie.
Fucking great.
It is our number one. If we did a coverage of all the Friday the 13ths, like the beginning of last year during one of the Friday the 13ths that happened during the year. And yeah, it's our number one. Mm-hmm. Part six.
For good reason.
Yeah.
You can do a lot worse than part six. That's a good show. Mm.
Sorry, you good? I had to call and get permission to watch The Mask when we watched it at a friend's house.
The Jim Carrey?
You are that friend.
Yes. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh. We had one of those.
Tell about the Ace Ventura thing.
No, we went to watch Ace Ventura, the first Ace Ventura, in theater. We didn't get to go to the theater very often because we were not well endowed with money.
As most people weren't.
That was my childhood, too. Don't feel bad.
Sure. So. Sure. So every time we would go to the movie theater, we would get one drink and we'd get one candy bar to split between like the kids, and my parents would get one between themselves, and we'd get the two youngest. I got in trouble for eating a whole candy bar because I wasn't aware that I wasn't supposed to eat the candy bar. I didn't tell you about that.
That's where Victor is at.
But no, we went and watched Ace Ventura, and as soon as he started talking with his butt, my mom took me out. And we went and watched
the movie.
We went and watched My Girl.
Those movies came out the same year.
That's I know. Dramatic,
though. That's like watching Never Ending Story.
He needs his glasses. His glasses.
We got
hands talking out his butt.
No,
it's
we got
too soon. Stop it.
We got there in the middle of the movie, and then when they have his funeral, I'm like, Mom, what happened?
Can we go home?
I'm like, I don't like this. What happened? And here I am. I'm an emotional. I don't even know how old I was at this time. Whenever it came out, I was like, I don't like this at all.
Better off with
man,
the, pet
with the talking butt was more enjoyable.
I like how we've gone from our experiences with Texas Chainsaw Massacre to this fucking kid who can't stand a bee sting. But anyway, carry on. I'm sorry. That's
it was multiple bees.
Too soon, damn it!
Stop it. Jeez.
The dad in Bridgerton died from a bee sting, so I mean.
Oh, spoiler alert to a show I'm never gonna watch.
Oh my god!
I was gonna get to Bridgerton.
They're in like season three almost.
That's nothing. No. I could binge
just
that
one
real easy.
Just one bee sting.
So, I don't know.
Oh, shit, I'm going down.
I guess he was highly allergic to it. No, but looking at watching the documentary we've been watching, it makes me more and more pissed off that I didn't get into special effects because I love special effects makeup and just special effects in general. But that was just like not, that was just like,
you not even on the radar that growing up.
No, yeah. Like I wanted to be in forensics since I was a kid. Ooh. When I first learned about what forensics was. And I didn't even get to go into that because I found out how long I was going to have to be in school and how much it was going to cost.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I can't afford that. I couldn't even afford to stay in a dorm room. Like, I can't even afford that.
What'd
like,
you get your car for? Carry on. Anyway.
Yeah.
What movie are we talking about?
I don't know.
Yeah, what's the
I don't know.
We're talking about Rodan, right? Can we talk about cool. that?
Yeah, exactly.
Yes, we'll just add it on to what we already...
We're not far
this
off.
This is Rodan After Hours.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Because oh. I'm covering this movie, I actually watched the beginning for the first time as well.
Yes. Well, I do want to talk about that movie just a little bit because I know probably most of you haven't seen the prequel to this, which I do recommend.
I avoided it until today.
Yeah, I do recommend it. I think it's fine. It's not as good as this one. And if you don't like this one, then it's not good at all.
But it has a bleak ending. That's what's cool about
that's
it.
That's the problem with prequels is it just like you already know what's going to happen. You just kind of get the origin of a lot of the characters you see in this one.
After this one, I have no idea what the order of the next movies are.
It's, so it went
like,
this one, TCM, the beginning. Then it was Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3D.
Yep. And that
and
one
then it was
the legacy sequel to the first one.
Yeah, where Alexandra Daddario plays a 45-year-old woman, but she's only like 25 in that movie. Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. Then there's Leatherface.
Leather. which is the origin story one
of Leatherface. If you
can second
figure that out, yeah. I think that's it. And then the 2022 one. So okay. Yeah, this franchise is weird. It's a mess, to be honest.
Continuity is not a strong sense.
No.
As much as terrible as the Halloween franchise is, this one's got it beat by a mile.
Like, do we start over again? Yeah. Do we keep starting over? No, just tell the story, damn it. I mean, geez, it took 12 years for Tobe Hooper to decide to make a sequel to the original. And then it just was like, that just doesn't feel like a sequel to the original. This is a comedy.
It's comedy.
I'm
yeah.
so confused.
It's totally comedy.
It's the comedy he wanted the first one to be, and he just went, well, let's just make it a real comedy this time.
Yeah, the tone was way different than the original, but I digress. Mm. So, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre from 2003 was directed by Marcus Nispo, who also directed the Friday the 13th remake in 2009. He was actually, his career was all going to start from directing End of Days, starring Arnold Schwarzenegger, but he ended up not getting the job because of, I guess, budget issues. So this was actually his first film, because he was well known for music videos and stuff like that. That's how he got involved with Michael Bay, who is a producer and the head of the studio that funded this movie. He would direct a Frankenstein movie in 2004, Friday the 13th in 2009, and Conan the Barbarian in 2011. And his last film was called Exeter in 2015. He went back to doing music videos and really hasn't done a whole lot since.
For the better.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
So this was the first Michael Bay remake.
It was.
Wasn't it, as well?
Yes. Yeah. So this was the first movie that he. Yeah. He started Platinum Dunes, which was the production company, and his whole vision was kind of to do what Blumhouse is doing. Like, that was kind of Platinum Dunes' original idea, which is just like low budget horror. And then they're like, well, why don't we? But his biggest thing was, I want the rights to Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Like, that, I want that to be the tentpole of all these. Because, of course, once this came out, then we just got Platinum Dunes was putting out remakes every year up until. Actually, I think they're doing another one very soon. I'm not really sure where they're at right now. Michael Bay is another one who's just like, what's he doing now? For me, I don't care. As long as it's not another Transformers movie.
Just remake the Boogans.
These movies were making a ton at the box office that opening week.
They would
drop hugely the second week. And then, like, they'd be one and done because we never got a sequel to the Friday the 13th one. We never got a sequel to the Nightmare one.
So
I know there's other ones.
I think the reason that there was no sequel to the 2009 Friday the 13th was the fact that there was disputes with the creators of the franchise.
Yeah, right. That's the hell and back.
Because they did have sequel ideas for that. We did cover the Friday the 13th remake earlier this year, so we talk a little bit more about
that's
that.
That's the one where there were tunnels under
Camp
Crystal Lake or something, right? Okay, I remember that.
Yep.
Mole people.
Mole people.
Mole Jason.
This movie was written by Scott Kozer, who would also pen the 2005 Amityville Horror remake, which...
Wasn't that the one with...
That was another one,
Reynolds, baby.
Ryan Reynolds.
That's the good one, right?
Sexy Ryan Reynolds. Oh, goodness gracious.
So originally, they were going to bring on... They had Tobe Hooper and Kim Henkel, who wrote the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. They had them come in to write a script. But nobody knows if the script that they wrote is the one that was used. Because, like, no one can clarify it. It's weird. I don't know. It's like no one will admit to it. It's like, maybe a little bit here and there. Yeah, it's a weird situation.
Hinkle is a douchebag as well. So, like...
Oh, no.
He's not really the only douchebag of this franchise. Well, at least for this movie.
Oh, yeah, but, like, Hinkle is the one responsible for Next Generation. And, like, if you listen to any documentary interviews with him talking about that one, it is just a man who does not listen to any other creative output, thinks he's the only one that's right. So I would be surprised that he wouldn't be the one like, no, I wrote this one single-handedly.
Oh, man. Gotta love those people.
The type of person he is.
They're the best. Makes you literally never want to be around them.
He's an alpha.
Yeah.
Of course, it was produced by Michael Bay and his production company, Platinum Dunes. And as we stated, they did a bunch of remakes throughout the knots with or the aughts, whatever the fuck, however you say it. The early mid to late 2000s. I think the last one was the Nightmare on Elm Street remake in 2010, which didn't do very well. And everybody hates it. This
poor
stars. I will always say he was a great Freddy. Sorry to anyone who disagrees with me. I think he was great, of great Freddy. This stars Jessica Biel, just coming off of her stint on Seventh Heaven, which was, this was definitely the way to go. Yeah, so you remember that show I was on where it was all, you know, Christian, you know, beliefs and all that?
Yep.
Whatever. Yeah, I'm going to go to a Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie and wear the tightest
clothing ever. You'd watch.
Yeah, you weren't allowed to watch R-rated movies, so you got to watch Seventh Heaven, where you're not allowed to kiss boys.
I did watch Seventh Heaven.
Told you.
But why is he looking at me like that?
Was that on CW?
Devil.
Was it on CW?
I think so. It was definitely whatever CW was before.
Is it Pretty Young People? It's CW.
Yeah. Pretty Young White Kids with Problems. That's what it is. From Mad TV. Yeah. Yes, that's what that shit is.
Listen, my mom watched Seventh Heaven every week, and so I somehow got sucked into watching that show.
Rude.
And it was crazy because I remember watching the show and then seeing Child's Play for the first time, and I went, that's the mom from Seventh Heaven? What the fuck is this? And then you find out that she's married to the guy who created Chucky. Like, he's the David Yeager who created Chucky. He did makeup work on some of the Nightmare movies, and I'm like, this is weird. And then the dad, we don't need to talk about him. He's disgusting.
I was about to say that.
Yeah.
It's like you can't talk about him.
No. So this also stars Jonathan Tucker, who, to be honest, I don't know anything else that he's done. Erica Lershen, who played whatever the other woman's name is. I'm awful with names. Pepper. Her name was Pepper. She was in Blair Witch 2. So there you go.
Some seasoning.
Oh, that. Avoid that one at all costs.
Yeah, and she was in Wrong Turn 2, so she was in a lot of sequels. We have Mike Vogel, who plays Andy. I thought this was the guy who did the voice of Anakin in the Clone Wars show, but he just looks like the guy who was the voice of Anakin Skywalker in the Clone Wars show.
I can never see what that guy looks like.
He was in Cloverfield, and I was like, oh yeah, that movie that I seen once and didn't like. She's Out of My League. I'm just naming movies I've seen. And the remake of Fantasy Island, which came out a couple years ago, which I don't think anyone saw.
The plane, boss. The plane.
The plane.
That's all I remember from that show.
We have Eric Balfour, who plays Kemper. And he was in a movie called Skyline, which was this weird alien abduction movie that came out in 2011. And he did a lot of stuff on sci-fi, like a lot of just B-rated schlocky movies over there.
He was in the first two episodes of the TV show Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh,
there you go.
If you ever,
there goes Pete again on his Buffy the Vampire pedestal.
He's our Buffy nerd over there.
He was on an episode of Dr. Quinn, Medicine Woman.
Is
an episode of Boy Meets World?
That was a good show.
Dawson's Creek?
Oh, Christ. You're the fucking Shocker. Dawson.
Yeah. What's up with Percy stealing your girl?
More pretty young people with problems.
Wanted to raise a bunch of weaklings. We'd have named them Dr. Quinn and Medicine Woman.
Oh, yeah.
Talladega Nights, baby.
Yes. Oh, thank you.
Oh, sweet baby Jesus. Why does it got to be a baby? Oh man, but the man who carries this movie, other than Leatherface himself, is R. Lee Ermey.
Sonny!
Who is just amazing in everything.
How can you not recognize his voice?
Fucking love Gunny, dude.
I was just waiting for, because like I wasn't watching this movie with like my kids in the room, but like my oldest would be like wandering around. And I was just waiting for him to hear his voice and be like, are you watching Toy Story? What the hell is going on here? What's going on with the army guys?
The soldiers, the plastic army.
Crazy,
dudes.
Man.
Yes.
But yeah,
I was waiting for him to yell, show me your war face to the guy in the van. I don't know how many times.
When he said the F word, which we will not say because you don't say that.
No.
I thought he said maggot. And I was like, yes. And Dan's like, that's not what he said. And I was like, shit.
I was like, I know that's what I want him to say. Cause I thought I was like, that's what mentally, like, that's what he's supposed to do. But yeah.
I'm like, that's what he said. He's like, no.
I mean,
he is a one trick, as far as an actor, he's the one trick pony. But
oh, yeah.
It's great every time.
He nails that fucking pony, man. That's
so good.
I'm not sure he could be a romantic lead, but what he does is gold.
No, he was in Saving Silverman.
What?
He got married to Jack Black. It was beautiful.
Okay, I need to see Saving Silverman.
You need to see Saving Silverman.
It's pretty funny.
He's the coach.
But he
is that a Kevin Smith movie or something?
Nope.
No.
Oh
no.
Steve Zahn and
isn't Sarah Silverman in that movie?
I can't remember.
I assumed it was because that's the only Silverman person I know.
Watch Saving Silverman, damn it. I'll let you borrow.
We've talked about 20 other movies.
You told you said you're gonna give me
we're supposed to be
yeah, that's how this show goes.
Yeah, that is how the show goes. 100%.
Yeah, there's no control. There's
movies.
Yeah.
Where's my
YouTube? Stay on track.
I do want to also mention another person that...
Keep going. No, keep going. I'm curious who you're going to go with.
Oh, the person that I pointed out. Lauren German, the teenager that...
Yeah, she was in Lucifer.
Yeah, she's got the natural holster between her legs. I got it.
Yeah.
Oh, the prison.
I mean, I was like, wait a minute. You can fit that there?
Yeah, we'll get to that.
If you're brave enough. If you're brave enough.
She is a main character on the... show Lucifer.
I was like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
I was like, she looked familiar, so I had to look it up. So, I was like, oh, it's her.
So I don't forget.
I love Lucifer, but.
I'll wait till we get to it. I don't mind her. Sorry. I'll wait till we get to it.
I mean, don't stop now.
So yeah, he plays. So Arlie Ermey, Sheriff Hoyt. And if you want to watch, in my opinion, his greatest performance is definitely the beginning of Full Metal Jacket. Sure. We have most iconic. We have David Dorfman as Jedediah. We've talked about him on the show before because he was the little creepy boy in The Ring.
Fuck that kid.
Oh, wow. The American Ring?
Yes.
Yeah. Good stuff.
Yes.
Really?
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. What's that? Sure.
He was also in the sequel, which is horrible.
the Japanese sequel is very good, by the way.
The funny thing is that the American sequel is directed by the director of the original Japanese Ring, which is just like, what? And then it turned out.
Yeah,
to
they brought him over.
It happens.
And we have Andrew Bernarski as Thomas Hewitt, a.k.a. Leatherface. We've also talked about him on the show before because he plays Christopher Walken's son in Batman Returns. He plays Chip Shrek. In Batman Returns.
He's Chip?
He is Chip.
What?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Are you serious?
We covered that last year, didn't
he?
He
is Chip, yeah.
We Batman did. Returns. We talked about him doing that walking impersonation.
Dude!
Yeah. He's in Geef and Street Fighter.
He's in Street Fighter as well?
Yes, yeah, he's in Geef.
Yeah.
Turn off the TV!
What?
Yes! He's in Geef in a fucking movie!
That's amazing.
God, we need to do the Street Fighter.
Yes,
we have to do Street Fighter. Plus, it's got a Godzilla reference in it too, so we have to do Street Fighter.
It does. Yeah.
He was in Any Given Sunday. He played. He was called Madman Kelly. He like would paint his face like a skeleton before games. He was in Scooby Doo, the live action Scooby Doo. I had to mention.
That
was a childhood staple for me.
That movie didn't suck.
No.
SMG.
It was pretty good.
And he would return to play Leatherface in the prequel, TCM The Beginning. His last film was in 2015. So a little controversy with this guy, because him and Gunnar Hansen, who plays Leatherface in the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, I guess they weren't big fans of each other. Gunnar Hansen actually was like, there was actually video of like Gunnar Hansen insulting Bernarski's performance as Leatherface, like talking shit about like, well, this is how Andrew Bernarski shuts the door, like that iconic, you know, sliding door. Yeah. And it was like really wimpy looking. And it was like they had this weird feud. And when Gunnar Hansen died back in 2015, Bernarski just, it was either a tweet or wherever, just put boohoo. And I was like, God damn.
That's not cool.
And
throw him shade at a dead man. That ain't cool.
I guess so. According to Wikipedia, which we all know how reliable it can be, but I guess a fan just said to him, "It's a nice of you to insult the legend that is Gunnar Hansen," and he replied, "Could give zero fucks, suck his dead nuts." I'm like, wow, God damn.
Wow.
His dead nuts specifically.
So yeah, they did not like each other. Funny. And then when Hansen died, it just got worse. And so a lot of people do not like Benarski. I've heard stories from people, and I've seen things like on Twitter about stories about him of the fact that like he's not the nicest person at like conventions and stuff. And he thinks he's like the Leatherface. It's just a weird situation. And it sucks because like his performance in this movie is really good. And, you know, in Gunnar Hansen's performance in the original is really good. To be honest, everybody in this franchise who plays Leatherface does a really good job. It's not, you know, there's not a lot of dialogue, of course. It's more in the action of the performer, you know, being able to kind of be scary, you know, and to show your size and be able to wield that chainsaw and make it scary. And I feel even with the bad Texas Chainsaw Massacre movies, you still have a good performance by whoever is behind the skin mask, you know? So, but it's kind of sad to read all that because it's like, I just wish everybody could just be nice to each other. Just right. This, like, Leatherface, like, support. Like, hey, man, this is really cool. We got to play the same character. We did our own thing. But yeah, that just sucks to read. But I just imagine him being Chip from Batman Returns. I'm like, well, he's probably that guy. That's who he is. You know, he's that guy. Another awesome addition to this movie is they brought back John Larroquette to do the narration at the beginning and the end of the movie. He is the one, of course, who reads the opening crawl of the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I'm not sure. I don't know if he comes back for any of the sequels.
He did for 2022.
Okay.
He does the narration on the documentary about Sally.
Okay.
In the very, very beginning.
Right.
He has like two lines or whatever, but.
What? Do you know what they paid him to do the narration on this film? Was it his...
Not this one, the first one.
The first one was like a couple of joints and a pat on the back or something.
Yeah, because he was like an unknown. Like this was like unknown, his biggest job at the time.
He was happy to come back for this one, I think, just for free.
He did a good job.
Yeah, that's awesome. It was really cool to have him come back. You know,
it's definitely... I mean, the original Texas Chainsaw, I watched it... couple months ago with my brother-in-law, and I'm like, hey, that's John Larroquette. It is not, and it's, you can tell it's a very young John Larroquette there. Mm-hmm. And in this film, it's definitely John Larroquette. It's yeah, unmistakably his voice at this point.
Right,
really cool addition. Another thing from the original is they brought the cinematographer back from the original. Ooh. Who we've talked about twice on this show because he was also the cinematographer for the Friday the 13th remake. Oh, I should mention his name is Daniel Pearl. He did Friday the 13th remake, and he also did one of the worst Alien movies, Alien versus Predator Requiem, one of the darkest movies ever made.
The filter. Take the filter off!
I can't see anything that is happening in this goddamn movie.
Yeah.
Turn the brightness up just a little bit. Dan, you can sit there with your smirk and, you know, say whatever you got to say, but you're the one who was like, I saw everything.
I never problem seeing anything in the movie. It was a little on the dark side.
It's
I saw
so
it.
Dark.
Turn the contrast up on your TV or something.
I don't want to
just put it in and watched it. Nah. That's it. It was fine.
Nah.
I ate my carrots, motherfucker. Nah. All right. Don't give me that shit.
That vision.
This movie was released almost 2 months after Freddy versus Jason. So we got three iconic horror characters on the big screen in 2003, which is pretty wild. Because I think Chucky's sequel, Seed of Chucky, came out in 2004. So imagine if we got all of those.
Seed of Chucky.
I love it. I love
so
them all.
So dumb and so wonderful.
I love them all. Give me more Chucky. Yeah. it was released October 17, 2003. It ran at 98 minutes, which is just a perfect amount of time. It has a budget of $9.5 million and made $107.4 million. No wonder we got 75 more remakes from 2003 to like 2011 or
like
whatever.
The first two weekends it made all that money.
It's wild.
Crazy thing, though, like this being 2003, because we mentioned this on our Freddy versus Jason episode where 20 years later with this movie, this is people's like certain generation's first introduction to Leatherface. Like you said,
we did say, yeah.
So like, it's the same thought process where you have, I know there's some people that I work with, like if I were to mention the original ECM to this one, they're probably gonna be more akin to this one because they were a kid when this one came out. Mm-hmm. And now 20 years later, like that's the one that scared them compared to the 70s one because of that being from the 70s, essentially. Like,
right.
There's always this.
I was going to say that this is your TCM. This is the first TCM you guys saw was this one. And I know I saw the second one first, but I still saw the original before this one. And that's why it leaves a weird taste in my mouth. But I can totally see where this generation watching this film today would go, this is terrifying. And I get it. I completely get it. It just, for someone who has seen the original and knows what it meant to horror, there's a little, it's a little tough to digest this new one. But trust me, I get it. Why, if this was your first one, why it's near and dear to your heart. I completely get it. Because it is. There's some really good, gritty, scary, some legit scary stuff in it. But we'll get into the rest of it later. I do not fault anyone for if this was your first Texas Chainsaw, that it is your favorite and it was the one that scared you the most.
Well, if you were
and
already
I just brought the whole.
No, I was just I was just trying to segue. I was
reaching
just trying to figure out a segue from that to what we're gonna go next.
Let's talk about this movie.
Do we want to talk? Are we all ready to talk about the plot of Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2003?
Yes.
All right, let's do it. So, of course, the opening of this movie is the wonderful narration by John Larroquette as he explains the now named Hewitt family, which
instead of being the Sawyer
the
family.
The Sawyers, right, yeah. And they're you know, we get the iconic like light bulb flash, like the camera flash sound effects as they're going through their.
Why was that name change done? Does anybody
No clue.
That was, like,
I don't even know. Like,
you don't say it's Jason Voorhees and then it's Jason
Samson.
Now, you don't change the name if you're. I don't know.
Well, they were going to give Jessica Biel's character the same last name as Sally.
Yeah.
And I was like, I don't understand.
But,
why not just
call
her Sally?
Sawyer. I mean, that's the name. That's the
You don't
change Skywalker's last name, right? Even if you remake the movie. Anyway, I digress.
Yeah, it's a weird point. One because as I said before, and as Pete stated, like this was my first Texas Chainsaw Massacre, so I just thought that was normal. I thought they were the Hewitts, mm-hmm. and then I remember seeing the original not too far after this one, and was like, Sawyer, what is right. what? All right, so
witness protection.
It's you get like this black and white. You know, they're recording. The cops are going through finding evidence. You're finding teeth in the river, and you know they go around and find things. And he's talking about all the evidence, and they're talking about how the best evidence they have is this video recording of a cop going down into the basement to investigate, and then it kind of cuts to our title card.
To me, that's the best part of this whole remake.
It's
the
good.
Opening
it's
and
good.
Closing with the black and white with the cop. Like that is solid horror right there. Like that part I fully enjoy having tacked on.
Yeah.
It made like I was really excited when I saw that.
Yeah.
The first time I saw this one, I'm like, oh, maybe we've got something going on here. This is nice.
But then when it goes to the title card and says the movie's in 1973, I forgot that this took place in 1973 because the remake I thought just took place in modern times. Because everyone is so goddamn good looking that all of them look like they are in 2003, not 1973. Even as the movie's trying to sell it to me, I'm like, nah, these are all definitely 2003. Like,
I feel like
it oozes like, early 2000s.
I feel like Morgan is the
these
only character.
Eat red meat. They don't drink beer. They don't eat red meat. Yeah. They're healthy young people.
Distractingly good looking, all of them.
Distracting, yeah.
Especially Jessica Biel. It's like there's no way. No, you know.
All I was doing was looking at her stomach. I don't know what else was going on in the film.
You were looking at her stomach?
That's her stomach, right, Nate?
Just the stomach. And you know what? Those early 2000 low-rise jeans.
Just north of the stomach is where, like, her... No, never mind.
But, like, my TV was, like, this ratio for some reason.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Really?
You had it zoomed in.
Oh, okay.
One particular... All right. Okay, I get it.
I missed
Nate.
The joke there.
This is why
Every
Nate
time
was late
she
today.
Came onto
he
the
was
screen, Dreamweaver played in the background.
That's it, man. That's it. It was distracting, though. Like, no, I had that filter. But I'll say that does make it distracting from knowing what the old, you know, Texas Chainsaw.
Not that they're
was.
Like bad looking in the old one whatsoever. It's just
but
like
very real. They're very.
This was just
they're tired kids on a road trip. They don't have any makeup on, and they're dirty and probably smelly. These people have had a professional do their makeup, and somehow,
like you said, the original movie you could smell, and it's not a good smell. This movie you can smell, and it's a very pleasant smell.
Yeah,
it's.
I have a contradiction
on the camera.
To that.
Please do.
The inside of that van. I see the inside of that van, and I see that same fucking blanket thrown over the back seat, and I'm a car guy, and I've been in 8 trillion old cars and fucking junkyards, and I can smell the back of that fucking water-stained, moldy-ass seat that's got a blanket over it, and you sit down on it, and you sit down on it in broad daylight, and you can see the dust poof into the air. Yeah, like, that's what I smell. They are well-groomed
communities back then.
Clearly, they are well-groomed people. I will tell you that. They're probably smell fine. The inside of that car, probably not so much.
I know there was as we get farther into the movie, I'm like, I don't think Jessica Biel probably smells good anymore. It was a weird thought that just popped in my head. I'm like,
I felt like she got better as she went on. I don't know. Maybe it was just me.
I won't kick her out of bed for stinking, let me tell you.
It doesn't help that, like, the camera is fully focused on how these people look. You know, like very rushed camera shots or anything like that to show the franticness. It is, oh, she's running, let's focus directly on her ass, let's focus on the rest of her assets, and oh, is it scary time? Okay, let's be a little bit scary. But that's what I mean by distracting with them.
I got an idea here. Let's just throw her in a white shirt and we're gonna have it rain on top of her.
It's gonna rain, and she goes into a slaughterhouse where there's a sprinkler.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. No. And she's sweating.
Water,
the good stuff.
All the water. So,
this was a little outnumbered here.
If this movie was made in the 80s, she would not have had a bra.
Sorry.
I'm telling you, it would have been a white.
No,
it would have.
Okay,
I don't think she had a bra.
You think they wore bras in the? Whenever this took place,
no, I know. I mean, she wouldn't have had it though. But in this movie,
she wouldn't have had a bra on.
No,
she probably wouldn't even have underwear on.
Probably not.
I mean, I'm surprised.
She has all the right to do that. I'm just saying, for the whole wet t-shirt competition.
I mean, I guarantee Michael Bay had some sort of input. It was like, hey, you know, it would be better if you didn't wear a bra. And she was like, no, I'm gonna wear a bra.
I wish they made Leatherface just have a white, you know, wife beater on with, you know, with him not wear a bra and him get wet. Yeah, him get wet too with her. So it's quality.
But he's attractive too. He's just like a handsome version of mankind in this movie.
Just a sweet little boy.
Everyone's too good looking.
He knows not to come around here.
Yeah. Arlie's eyebrows, those are perfect. They're on point.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Everybody's groomed so well in this.
Yeah,
way too well.
So, we meet our core group of characters who are on their way to a Lynyrd Skynyrd concert in Dallas.
Couldn't they have picked anybody else?
They came from Mexico where they got a pound of weed. A pound? Whoa!
Of the marijuanas.
And it's in a piñata.
That spinach leaf marijuana.
Oh, sorry, it was 2 pounds. I even wrote it down. It's 2 pounds.
Give me some of that jazz. Give me some of that jazz cabbage.
Oh, man. But yeah, you kind of meet everybody. You meet the two. It's Andy and Pepper that are making out in the back seat. They just picked up Pepper like the day before. You have Morgan.
I can't believe we just met yesterday.
Who's just he's the Franklin of this movie. You know, Franklin from the original. He is Franklin. He gets tortured probably.
He gets
most.
Shit on so bad. But he sells it.
Yeah, he gets it the worst.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So they're driving in this really cool van, and they almost hit a hitchhiker who doesn't look very good. And so they end up picking her up.
She's rough.
Yeah. It's, I don't want to sound like a piece of shit, but keep going. Sorry.
Exactly. It's the 70s, though. This hitchhiking was a thing back.
This is how you get a horror movie or a porno star.
But this poor gal is certainly in distress.
Yeah,
so.
she looks really bad. And of course, Aaron is the one.
Keep driving for sure.
But yeah, because Aaron is the one who makes him stop to pick her up. And so she, you know, she's going through all the emotions. She's crying. She's pretty much, you know, stating that she's trying to get away from him and, you know, and all that. And then they enter into the town and she starts to freak out because she's like, you're going the wrong way. You're going the wrong way. And she almost makes the van crash. And they stop. And that's when she literally like breaks down and just whips a pistol out of her crotch. Like a fucking magician pulling a rabbit out of
a hat. What is the name for that? Ham wallet? What is it?
Prison
deep,
purse.
Deep concealment. Deep concealment.
Yeah. And yeah, she sticks in her mouth and blows herself away. And you get the really awesome camera shot where it actually goes through the hole in her head.
It's good effect.
Very cool.
It's a great. I don't know how they pulled that off at all.
So they had to saw the top of the van and it was like a pulley system, like a track system that would.
Really?
Get it to go through, yeah.
Oh, that's
cool. It was a dummy, of course. It was really funny to watch like the outtakes of them trying to get the shot because like they would shoot it and sometimes the head would flop forward or would flop to the side so they couldn't get it. Because they needed the camera shot to go through it to see the rest of them reacting to what happens. It's really cool.
Yeah, I've seen that camera shot.
Is like the best part of the remake.
Yeah.
Like it's just it's unique. You see it go from the back of the van as well and one singular flow. Like it's just that's something that's cool.
Yeah, at this point I'm still on board with this film.
Yeah.
In the original cut of this movie, this was actually a lot more graphic. They had to take stuff out.
And this is still graphic. I mean, you still see her
blow the back of her head out.
Yeah.
They don't skimp around it. Originally, her really character was supposed to be like 15 or 16 years old, and they ended up changing it because they just thought it was going to be too much.
Yeah.
It's Texas Chainsaw. I can totally see where that would have been, and a 16-year-old, that would have added to the horror.
Oh, yeah.
But it might have gotten NC-17 for the age of the person.
I like this hitchhiker compared to the original one, though, because like the original one, he just cuts his thumb, and you know they kick him out. And this one's like, oh no, they have a dead body they now got to deal with. And it kind of progresses that plot of they have to call the sheriff. They got to do something about this.
Here, for sure.
Yeah, because it's you know, the original, you'd later find out, spoiler alert, that he is one of the brothers. He's like part of the Sawyer family. Right. Where this one is like, she's a victim of the family. And as you see throughout the film, you see like remnants of past victims, which I really liked being able to, like, you don't know who anybody is, but you like you see the pictures or just, and it's never focused on unless a character picks something up, but they'll be like walking by, you'll see like a pair of shoes or you'll see sometimes you see like I saw a pair of teeth, but it's not something they were focusing on. I really liked how they kind of added that in. So they freak out, they throw the weed pinata into the grass. They're trying to figure out what the hell they're going to do. They got to get rid of the body, so they got to find some help. So they go to this really clean looking general store, and they meet this lovely old lady, and they're like, can you call the police for us? And she's like, I got you. And she calls them up.
It costs you a dime.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's like, I don't care.
The refrigeration unit is no longer good in that case. I am telling you.
I don't think anybody was going to go in there and buy anything. And it's a lot of flies. So yeah, she calls the sheriff, and then she pretty much is like, yeah. So he wants you to meet him at this mill, and they're like, what? Why can't he come here? Well, it's just going to take him too long. He's already doing something, and you know it's just gonna be easier if you go meet him there.
He's like 2 hours out.
As soon as I hear that, I'm like,
that's when you push the body out and drive away. Be like,
it's your problem.
Yep. Yes, not mine.
I was thinking that the whole time. I'm like, oh, you know how we can fix this? I'll make it your problem, and that cop will come out straight away.
Yeah. But
no, it's no longer my problem.
I mean, finding out what you find out at the end of the movie, I don't think anything would have happened, to be honest. They could have dumped the body and drove away, and they'd been like, well, we wanted her anyways. She was part of... Yeah, she escaped in the first place.
Supper's ready.
Yeah.
It tastes like chicken.
So they go to the mill, but the cop doesn't show up. It takes them a while. And then they vote on whether or not they're going to get rid of the body and just leave or not. And Aaron, of course, is like the voice of reason. She's like, no, we can't do that. She has a family. We can't, you know, they need to know where she is. You know, and then she then wanders off because she hears a noise.
This Where is are you going? Fault. They would have survived.
You're right. This is all her fault.
They would have survived. She would have been outnumbered.
I think Morgan was the voice of reason this whole time. Like, let's just fucking leave. Yep. He's like, this whole time, sure just fucking leave.
Yeah.
So he was the less annoying Franklin.
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, she
is Franklin redeemed.
Yes.
For sure.
Rise from the chair, young Franklin.
You talk about Franklin, and I cannot help when you mention him to think of the annoying kid from Friday the 13th, Part 5. Hey, you want to buy my chocolate bar? He gets his head.
Oh, that's right.
That's what I'm thinking of. Like,
fucking Roy.
Yep.
Was Franklin the turtle or whatever?
Oh yeah. Attacked by Gamma or Kaiju.
Franklin. Sorry.
I don't know.
I'm just over here singing "Viva Pinata." Damn it.
Damn it.
So she wanders into this abandoned mill.
It's filled with fun.
Yeah, but it's filled with weed now.
Yeah.
Which is fun for some
weed
people.
Weed is fun for some people.
And they find a possum inside like a cabinet, which I loved reading the behind the scenes of this one because they couldn't get the possum to react like they wanted to. He was just being too adorable every time they would open the case.
Yeah,
they were going to kill it. My wife's like, no, possums are great.
I got time for possums. Yeah, they're good.
Anytime I see a possum on the road, I'm like, I want to stop. I want to pick this guy up. He's my new friend.
I'm going to put him in my backyard. I'm never going to have ticks again.
Never going to have ticks or grubs or nothing. Yep.
Yeah,
they're good.
And they won't get killed by a snake.
I don't have that problem, but that's a good.
Well, we have copperheads.
Good piece of knowledge to have.
Oh, that is a Tennessee thing. That's for sure.
One of two.
And water moccasins. Those are bad.
Ah, man.
Yes. I don't remember
the look angry.
All right.
They are.
I don't. One of two. Well, we also have rattlesnakes here, too. Yeah. One of two native marsupials to the United States. Possums.
What's the other marsupial?
I can't remember it. I'll look it up.
Platypus?
Yeah, I thought they were the only one.
No, Matt, platypus are Australian.
Australian. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Because they have to have the only venomous mammal. Thank you, Australia.
Right.
Platypuses are God's joke anyway. So
God's like, I'm out of ideas.
That was Australia. Australia was where all the rejects for the creation, the animal creation went. They're like, no one's going to go there.
The island of misfit toys. But
exactly.
That's what the British did with their prisoners. I mean, it makes sense.
Don't leave your shoes outside. Don't leave them on the floor because you might
never go. I'm just never going to visit. Take that, Australia. You don't get me.
Don't pick up anything out of the water so you don't get the nasty snails that can like pierce your brain through your ears.
Oh, no, it's not through your ear. That's cone snails.
Yeah. Don't.
Now that's a new fear unlocked that I didn't need.
Well, no, I just wanted to quote. I just also wanted to bring a quote in of for Jurassic from Lost World. So what happens if you shoot yourself in the foot? Don't do that because you'd be dead before you realize you made a mistake. That's what he talks about. It's the venom of Conus pepperasus. That's exactly what he's talking about. They make they have a myotoxin. They can actually make almost any kind of toxin within their body. And they will fuck you up.
I just hate this more and more.
It's not going to Australia ever.
They have one of the venomous octopus in the world. It's like that big.
Yeah, hobbits and shit.
It's close.
They go to New Zealand.
What are you talking about? They have the creature from Dead Alive there. That's
shit with the saggy tits.
I'm game. I'm fully down. I'll be Mama's little boy.
Mary and Monkey or something like
the
that.
The Monkey Rat.
Yes, Mary the Monkey. Monkey Rat. Yes.
That's what it is. Yep.
Yep. From Skull Island. So they also find, after they find this possum, they also find Dirty Boy Jedediah, who
I hate this motherfucker.
Man, they could not give this kid realistic looking fake teeth because they just look like teeth he got at a Spirit Halloween.
And he tries to pretend he's
trying
a hillbilly
to get him to stay in. He's constantly licking the top of his mouth.
Which I've grown up with people that have teeth that actually do look like this. And I'm like, I don't think I've ever seen them lick their teeth. I'm like, what the hell is he doing? I was like, did he eat something and he just can't get it out of his teeth? I couldn't watch
that's
him.
Possible too.
I
just
could
trying
not
to keep him on track half the time. I swear he's looking around
his mouth.
Like they did, like they did to Mr. Ed, and put peanut butter in his mouth to make him lick his fucking gums. Like, stop it.
So they asked him, it's like, hey, we're looking for the sheriff. And he's like, oh, he's at home getting drunk. And they're like, Morgan's just like, well, if he don't give a shit, I don't give a shit.
Neither
let's get rid of this body. And that's when everybody should have went, you know what, Morgan? You're right. Instead, Aaron goes, no, we're going to go. Where does the sheriff live? And we're like, I don't want to be friends with her anymore.
She's just like, listen, I'm going to tell you what's the best for everybody. I was like, all right, we'll see you later.
She can walk home.
We'll leave you here with the body and we're out. Just we're going to go see Leonard Skinner.
Yeah, exactly.
You're
front row to Leonard Skinner.
Yeah.
I've seen Leonard Skinner. It was weird.
I have too.
That's a way I've never heard it described before.
I suppose it was the crowd that was weird, not the band. Anyway.
Maybe you had to be there for 70s Skinner. Maybe like, but everything probably was weird in 70s.
This was 90s Skinner. This is after this.
Yeah, you need to be there for the original Van Zant, not Brother Van Zant.
Yeah, we didn't have that.
That's what I saw. But the opening group was a country version of AC/DC, and they were called AC Dixie, and that was definitely something new for me.
It's clever. I like that.
In a world that has been completely divided for so long, two movie fans have decided to unite for the people and the betterment of mankind. One, an action movie buff.
Yippee-ki-yay, mother.
The other, a horror movie fanatic. Together, they will try to bridge the gap of both genres into one podcast with their battle cry, "Give me back my action and horror movies." Listen along as Charlie and Nate alternate each week talking about action and horror movies they cherish, mostly from the VHS era. Also, including some modern examples that felt like the movies they grew up with by answering the battle cry, "Give me back my action and horror movies." Available wherever you listen to podcasts. Look them up on Facebook and Instagram.
So, Aaron and Kemper venture to the sheriff's house, and the rest of them just wait at the van, you know, just in case the sheriff shows up. And this is what like I was talking about earlier, this is where they're wandering through the woods and they see like all the burnt up cars and like just remnants of victims past, but they don't know that. They just think it's just junk in the woods as they're making their way through.
If I was in this universe, I'd be dead, by the way. So I'm like, oh, old cars. I should go ask them about that. And then I'd be murdered. Like that's exactly.
This one. Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. That's like,
he just taps on the floor. Of
it. Got a title?
Oh, yes. Oh,
yeah. Okay. That's title. What'd you look in the trade here?
No, you wouldn't even. I know it exactly how it would go because I've dealt with people like this. This thing got a title. She don't need no title for those. You just drive it around because that. I mean, you're in
that's
the sticks.
Before titles. Yeah, that's before titles. Can I buy it? No, it's not for sale. I'm gonna fix it up one day. You have 357 cars out here.
Yeah, but one day this one. I know what I got here.
Okay. Okay.
What you got to?
I gotta tell the story. I fucking love this real quick because I've mentioned it before and y'all probably hadn't heard it. My dad went stopped at this one guy's. This was. Fuck, I don't know. Probably when I was really low. Yeah, you know the story. It's probably like over 30 years ago. I wasn't around for this. My dad stopped at a place. This guy had an old Challenger in this yard. It was like a 72, 74 Challenger. Ooh. It was just sitting there forever.
Ooh, that's sexy.
I know. And he went up to him and he's like, what do you want for it? And he's like, well, you can have it, but there's a catch. There's a tree growing through the center of the engine bay. There's no engine in it, obviously. You can have it if you can take the car without cutting the tree down.
Okay.
That was it. That was like, I was like, why the fuck you gotta be a dick about
it? Did your dad do it?
No. He's like, fuck that. Because oh. You'd have to cut, you could fix it. Like, I don't know how big the tree is. You could just cut the radiator support out and hopefully it wasn't much clearance on the shock towers, just back it up. But the guy was just being an asshole to be an asshole.
And so I was hoping that the guy was going to be like, the car's cursed, you see. It's known to murder people, you see. If you want the curse, you see.
Well, do you got anything else? Well, I've got yogurt. The Froger is also cursed or whatever. It's the same thing.
It has potassium, whatever. That's bad.
Yes. Can I just go? It was relevant. I just felt like bringing it up.
It also comes with sprinkles. That's good.
Evil sprinkles.
So they make it to the house and they are met by the Legolas man that lives there. And they ask, like,
Legolas?
Oh, yeah, Legolas.
Legolas man.
Yes.
Old Legolas. Legolas.
Oh, and he can walk Legolas. On top of the snow.
He's got like Gimli's head mounted on the front.
Legolas is beautiful.
No, he's got to have Gimli like stuffed on the couch. And he's like, morning, old friend. Just walks in. Leatherface took care of it for him.
No, I to be honest, I don't even remember. Oh, Old Monty is his name.
Is that his name?
Yeah, his name is Monty. Monty. Yeah, you hear
this
him.
Has to be our Gramps analog.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. So they ask if the sheriff lives there. He says no, but he'll call him for them. And they're like, okay. So in the beginning, the prequel movie to this, you find out why he has no legs. And it's hilarious.
Did you lose him in a dancing competition?
Not that hilarious.
He might as well have.
He was cutting the rug.
Damn.
I can square.
I mean, I can share it with you all if you don't care. But
it is.
I don't care. Give me it.
So, something happens to one of the legs, and so they ask Thomas to cut one of
the knee.
Yes, and so they're like, yeah. "Oh, Thomas, you got to cut the one leg off." And while he's cutting the one leg, he accidentally nicks the other one. And so Sheriff Hoyt goes, well, you got to make him even, and just cuts them both off. And so that's why he has no legs.
And then the mom's like, why'd you have him do that? He goes, balance.
Balance.
Oh, God.
Dude, I really, that's so stupid and wonderful, but I really would have loved
it. It is.
That horrible.
You know what?
Go ahead.
Prequel is about as dumb as like the Han Solo prequel movie where it's like, we're not going to give you an origin about the character. We're going to give you an origin about how this guy lost his legs
and
how the
sheriff
got the uniform. Yeah. Like, that's it.
Oh.
The reason why Leatherface is Leatherface, he was born. That's why.
Yes. I was hoping it was like about the old Central Texas square dancing accident of 68.
We don't talk about that square dancing accident. A lot of good people lost their legs.
Oh.
So, yeah, I love it when they go inside, or she goes inside to call the sheriff. And, you know, she's talking to, I'm guessing, the actual police. And they're like, yeah, we'll be out there in like 30 minutes. Here's this is something that confused me, because she says, oh yeah, we'll be there. Did they ever show up there? Because the time frame from when she talks to them to when everything else happens in this movie is definitely longer than half an hour.
I want to say, he says, hey, I'll dial them for you. I don't think he called the sheriff.
Oh, you think that he actually
just
like,
called,
talked to somebody
he just called
random?
Probably someone in
she
their little click.
Oh, yeah, that's
somebody
weird.
In their click. Is this the sheriff's office? Yes, yeah. Wink, wink. Yeah. We'll send
it's
them
the
right
girl
out.
At the gas station, probably, or something.
Yeah, because that's their mom, or it could have been the other ladies on the property
that makes
didn't
sense.
Have a phone. Yeah, one of those things.
That didn't have a phone.
Because in the prequel, they do mention that that's the only cop that gets killed that Ermy takes over as. So then, like, that was another thing. I was like, well, if she's talking to a cop, then clearly, like, they found a replacement in 5 years.
I just assumed he wasn't a cop. It was just a charade.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Charade.
That's fine. We can do that.
He just takes the uniform.
In Texas Chainsaw Next Generation, like, the cops were part of the whole family.
Well, that's because they are part of the Illuminati, you see. There's a whole big thing in the Next Generation.
I forgot. Yes.
You remember? The government pays people scare people.
Yes.
That way we can live off the energy like Monsters Incorporated.
Yes.
Yes.
We talked about this, Pete. Come on, man.
Yeah, Pete. Come on now.
I don't remember shit. You know. Don't you remember that I don't remember shit?
So Texas Chainsaw Massacre. So Texas Chainsaw Massacre and Monsters, Inc. are in the same universe?
Basically, yeah.
Okay. That's our theory.
All because of the Illuminati. But yeah, that's
Monsters,
kind of
Inc. is in every
universe.
Right
now.
Okay, yeah. That's fair.
I mean, I can
those have all
you
the doors.
Open a door, yeah, all it the opens doors. A possibility to another universe. So
That's right.
Okay. I can see it.
Yeah, you can open one of those doors and it's to a Balrog universe. How would you
shit.
Yeah.
They only show the good ones. They don't show
Balrog
bad.
Balrog sitting in the office. Can you copy this for me?
So as she's going to leave, the
soundtrack.
The guy in the wheelchair is calling for help. Would you help him?
No.
No.
I'll follow. And I can't get up. Life alert. We don't get signal out here.
Twice this cop has not showed up. That I got no time for nobody.
Yep.
Forget it.
Yep.
And he's grabbing Alba's butt the whole time.
He's getting a handful of cheek, man. He's anchoring that, man.
He's like, oh, help me. He might as well be,
girl. Like, but I'd have slapped
him. That's his character, and I appreciated that grossness.
It's funny, because this is his distraction so that Leatherface can kill Kemper.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. It's hilarious, because, like, how does all this happen and she doesn't hear any of it? So
that's what I said. It's a big house.
Not a big house.
Yeah,
it seems like it. Like, it has to be a mansion for nobody to hear me yelling.
So, right. Yeah, while
the walls
he's,
are made of cement.
Yeah. While he's
where they hide the bones is in the.
Just fill the walls with the bones.
Well, that's the thing is, this house is very different from the original. So like the original was very much like Ed Gein's house was described.
Yeah.
Which is what this movie is, or what the series is based on. Which I did not know that when I saw this movie and thought the beginning and the end of this movie was actual footage of a text of this Leatherface guy until probably a couple years later. And I was like, no, read this book. It's about serial killers. And then I was like, Ed Gein.
Did Larroquette say that this was based on a true story in this movie? Because he did in the original.
He does. Yeah, he pretty much does. And it says it on the front, on the cover of the movie and all that stuff. So,
Okay.
Yeah. So in the original, the house had bones all over the place. You know, you could tell like this was a family of cannibals. Like they didn't hide anything. Where this house, they're hiding things very well. So like, you know, because you see Kemper wandering through the house. And the only weird thing to me would be like, yeah, it's dirty. But also there's just pigs just wandering the house.
And chimpkins.
Yeah. So, but it's Texas in the middle of nowhere, so I guess it might not be that surprising.
Well, that's what you do, man. You just have the front to be literally a front. So if somebody comes over, they see what seems like just an old home.
Oh,
they're gonna be dirty.
This movie is so much deeper now than I thought it was, because it's a front to,
I'm just saying,
mind is
man.
Blown.
And then you go to the kitchen. You're like,
where do you go, man?
I'm the one that usually digs deeper into.
I have never heard someone not give a shit as much as Pete just did right there.
That was thick, bro.
Also, what's really cool is this house is real. Like, you can actually visit this house.
I want to go. Let's go.
Yeah.
And the house from the original as well.
I want to quit my job and go travel.
We're going to go to Texas?
I want to go to all these.
And not just not to Houston.
I don't fucking care where we
You
go.
Want to visit the house in Halloween and the Amityville house and the.
I want to go to Salem. I want to go. You know,
let's go hang out.
I want to go everywhere.
I'm just going to go in there and shit on their floor like I was here.
At least want to pee in their bathrooms.
That's weird.
That's all I need.
All right.
I've marked my territory.
This is mine now, bitch.
So the sheriff shows up. The sheriff, in quotation, shows up to the van. And he's wonderful. I just love where he like goes through and he's like, I'm gonna guess that you got a dead body in that van.
I mean,
this is great detective work, son.
This is my favorite. This is my favorite. Like, this is just Arlie Ermey line. Excuse me, son. You mind getting the fuck out of my way? And like, just go.
Yeah.
Like, you can tell he's not just mad at this kid. He's just like mildly annoyed, but that's just how he is. It's fantastic. Yep.
And mildly so annoyed is more gross. Terrifying than most people's anger.
Oh, it's so good. So good.
So they, he comes up with the idea of wrapping up the body with saran wrap, which is just
this great. Is an everyday thing for him. He's like, oh yeah, well, let's wrap her up.
And your ass over here. I've never done this before.
Yeah, and I'm getting all the nasty comments from him as he, you know, oh, she's still wet down there. And you know, he's like comping a feel and.
I also wonder how many different takes they have of him just like ripping.
Oh, he 100% ad
libbed. How he is? Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
And how many of them just could hold it during those? Because he just
You also get the shot where he sees the gun and they tell him like where the gun came from, and the gun fits perfectly in his holster, which it took me a long time to realize the gun was his.
Yep,
I just thought he found the gun and was like, oh, I got this holster here. I could just put it in there.
Boot, though.
Yeah.
Boot holster, yeah.
Yeah.
Boot gun or something. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's a backup holster.
Fit perfectly.
Yeah. Which is funny because I think Pepper looks at one of the other gentlemen because she sees that and somebody else sees it and she looks at him and, like, kind of like, this is weird.
That one guy does go, like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
And no one else catches on.
Yep. Yep.
Which, again, how many red flags do you need in a movie for people to go, peace, I'm out.
Yeah, no shit.
Yeah.
So we then go back to the house where Kemper gets attacked. You know, you get the whole thing where he's wandered in the house. He goes into he hears like a TV going on in a room. And then, of course, it's the perfect drop because there's like a drum scene in this cartoon that's playing on the TV to the point where Leatherface comes up and hits him in the back of the head. I guess this scene was supposed to be a lot more gory. Like you were supposed to see him get hit in the head and it was just like an explosion. I
like this better. I wouldn't have liked it if there was a blood splatter. This was fast and brutal and in and out. And that was this might be my favorite scene of the whole movie where that door opens, bam, drags him in, door closes. See? I was still on board at this point.
This is where they start to lose me, which is funny because, like, I think in the original, when the first hammer gets hit and the way you just see the body fall and the leg twitching and then the slow drag, like, to me, that's like horror perfection. And, like, once they did with this one, how quick it is, the blood splatter on the wall is like, well, all right, let's see where this goes from here. But, like, especially after revisiting the original one, like, 2 months ago, it's like, oh, yeah, God, that's it's so shocking and scary. Yeah. Well,
I think it's the great part.
Yeah, I think it's. I don't mind the scene as much because I think the problem is, like you said, with the original, is I think it's better in the original because the guy just runs up, it opens, it's fucking motherfucker, and he just fucking pows the dude, falls over, twitches a little bit, pulls inside, shuts door, and it's like almost just one shot. And this
just
like
happens, and you're like, oh, yeah. And like the late twitch is such a fine, like, detail. Yeah. Like,
but like,
I think the original TCM has some of the best acting in a horror movie. Like, we'll get to it with the hook
that time. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. But like, in this one, like, he hits him, and then there's like the cut, and then there's the other stuff, and he kind of like drags him, and then pulls the door. It just seems it's works, but it's just doesn't seem as intense as the original. It's just so quick and like one thing, like bam, dude falls, book drags him inside, shuts the door, and there's like multiple cuts and him dragging him in this one. It just seems longer, drawn
it's
out
janky.
More in this. Yeah. But it's not bad. It's just, I think it's what done better in the original.
Is he not still twitching though when he pulls him? Or
he does twitch him a little bit, but it's better. I think he does twitch.
No, he's convulsing like on the ground as he's dragging him to the door.
I thought maybe it was my brain playing trick because I'm like watching. I was like, is he still got the axe in his head? Like, is he pulling him by that, or is he just
the scene's also
or his hammer?
An axe? Yeah. Was a but, hammer. Okay.
Or hammer, but is he like still pulling him, or was he actually pulling his body? Because I thought he was pulling the body.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He wasn't dragging him by the.
It would have been kind of awesome. If he was.
Oh, like he hits him so hard, it's like impaled in him, and he just drags him like that. Yeah. No, I like
another one.
Just dragging the body with his hand.
That's gnarly.
And of course, we get the iconic recreation of the scene from the original where he pulls him into the room and slams a big door. The door in this one is like 10 times the size of the door in the original. The original one's like this small aluminum sliding door where this one is a vault.
Gotta keep this
different budgets.
Yeah. So we go back to the car or to the van where Sheriff Hoyt is taking the body. And I love it. Where he's like, yeah, put it in the back of my car. They go to put it in the back seat. And then he notices, don't put that shit in the back of my car. Put it in the trunk.
What it's what he says before. He's like, listen, lady, I got respect. I got enough respect for a dead body of anybody else out here. As much respect for a dead body as anybody else out here. Don't put that disgusting thing in the back of my fucking car. Put it in the trunk.
Don't break any of my shit in the trunk either.
Yeah, I know. Oh, dude.
Don't break anything.
I laugh. When that line comes up, like, back, I always laugh. I think it's fucking great.
So Aaron gets back to the van, and she's like, oh, yeah, the sheriff's coming. And they're like, well, he was already here. And then she goes, where's Kemper? Is he here? And I'm like, how do you just lose him? Like,
yeah, how?
So
system.
Of course she's like, oh, well, we got to go back and find him, and most of them are like, yeah, I don't really want to. This doesn't seem like a good time.
No, we don't.
So she eventually talks him into it. They find another like car graveyard where they find teeth, they find a jar full of what I'm guessing is piss, and a picture of the hitchhiker and her family. And they're like, well, that's a little sketchy, you know.
This is where the horn is going off, isn't it?
Yeah, the horn's going off.
He
I think that's the little kid to lure him to that. Like, hey, there's something going on here.
There's somebody here.
Like, that wouldn't work that way, but okay.
Yeah, it also would work because there's no battery hooked up. Horns don't work like that. But anyway, that's fine. That was my first thing. I was like,
logic,
Dan.
Logic.
I'm sorry. It's just a car from like 55 sitting there. And it's like,
it's all about the logic here.
Well, which is actually another thing, which I don't, this isn't for Arlie Ermey's character. I don't think he's a sheriff. I know. I've never seen the prequel, and you guys.
No, he's not. He's not.
No, no.
He's a family member that's wearing a sheriff uniform.
Yeah, that's what I figured, because his, not to mention his cruiser is a piece of shit. And like, I know it's a small rural town, but they always usually take care of their cruisers anyway. And that's a 65 Belvedere. So it's at least 8 years old. And even if it was dated, it would still be taken care of. And this thing is just beat up. So.
Yep.
And obviously, he doesn't act like a sheriff, but you know.
And the prequel takes place in 69 when he does get the
nice
car.
Okay, that's fair.
Oh,
so they go when they split up again. You got two of them going back to the van, and then Aaron and Andy go back to the house. And this is where you get another recreation of an iconic shot of the, you know, the low shot of one of the women walking towards the house.
Yeah.
This time it's on Aaron as she goes to talk to whatever his name is, Monty. And Andy tries to sneak in back and to investigate and try to find where Kemper is. This is when it all hell breaks loose, because the guy figures out that Andy's in there. And then, of course, you get the whole like showdown between them where Andy thinks he's going to fight Monty, and Monty's just hitting the floor. But what he's actually doing is calling Leatherface, and he just swings that door open. He's got the chainsaw. And yeah, this is where the movie goes from like 50% to like fucking 150. It's just nonstop chaos for the rest of it. And I love it when, you know, he's got the tire iron, he's blocking the chainsaw with that. I thought that was pretty cool.
It's not cool because it's not real. If a chainsaw would hit a tire iron, it would kick right back to the person holding the chainsaw and probably
cutting
his arm off or something.
Test this.
That one. I hate chainsaws in horror movies because you never
what if we
do
test
it right.
Leatherface is a beast. He doesn't let that shit kick back.
No, it doesn't work like that, man.
No, he's like just got those broad shoulders that are just like, bee, 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 bee.
One, a chainsaw never starts in the first pull. Two, it hits something metal. The chainsaw's going to bounce right back at you, period. I don't care how strong you think you are.
Leatherface sleeps with his chainsaw on his bed. Okay, he takes good care of that thing.
Oils it.
I'm wrong.
He rubs it.
To doubt the Leatherface abilities.
Well, there actually is a few times in this where he pulls the star's chainsaw, and it takes him more than one time to get it going.
You're right. You're right. And even in the Next Generation, the TCM, what we did, there was a couple of great scenes where he was trying to start the chainsaw at the. It's so unusual to see that.
No, no, I agree, because like you said, they just
even,
they
even in the Evil Dead movies, like Bruce Campbell, God bless you, starts that chainsaw every first pull every goddamn time. And I still love the hell out of it.
Oh, have any of you guys played the Texas Chainsaw game at all?
Yeah, it's a lot.
Nate has.
So I noticed. I've only ever seen the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, this one, and the 2022. Like, those are the only ones I've seen, or 2021, whatever it came out.
Watch them all.
Did the element with the chickens and the pigs, like, alerting people, did that come from this movie?
That's a good question. I just assumed, because it being a farmhouse, that was just something they were wanting to incorporate a gameplay mechanic in.
Yeah, because, like, if, for those of you who don't know, when you play, because you play as either the bad guys or the good guys, and you won't, and, right. and like, you could, you know, if you're in the Sawyer home, then, like, the if you, like, people going through, they would alert, like, chickens would make noise. You're like, oh, they're near the chickens, and then, like, so, like, that's what I thought. I was like, is this from the game?
The game's firmly planned with just the first movie. Like,
yeah, I know. But I thought maybe the element
that DLC for part two will happen. But, yeah, it's definitely strictly first movie with that.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's a good question.
So, Andy is running away from Leatherface. And this is the one shot that was really jarring, where he's going through the sheets. It just keeps cutting back between him and Leatherface.
Yeah.
And it's just too many times. Like, just focus. I think it would have been better if they just focused on Andy running through and then getting the shot of Leatherface just coming out of nowhere and just chopping his leg off. I think that would have been way better than it was just like, okay, you see him, you see him, you see him. I'm like, I feel like I was watching Resident Evil, the final chapter, where I was like, fuck me, man. This
is
awful.
We don't talk about that one.
It's awful.
Because I'm like, where did he come from? Because as many times as it was back and forth, it looked like Leatherface was right behind him.
No, he was standing on the outside of the sheets going, what is he doing?
He's just, go over here?
He just casually walks in and just...
Yeah.
You're making
That is a slasher trope, though, where the killer comes out of absolutely nowhere, right?
Yeah.
Tell me that doesn't happen in every Jason movie.
Yeah,
they know how to teleport.
Yeah, this is the only, I think, instance of that when it comes to Leatherface, because, like, you feel in this movie Leatherface is just a man. Like, he is, he's not supernatural in any way.
He's a miserable pile of secrets.
He is a miserable pile of secrets.
So he grabs Andy and his now detached leg and drags him to the basement. You get the nasty close-up shot of his fingernails getting ripped off his hand. So fucking worse. But of course, it's a callback to the opening scene where the cop's walking down the basement stairs and you know, he shows the fingernail marks. So it's like, oh, well, that's where they came from.
From someone who has fingernails that I've actually gotten ripped. Oh, I'm so sorry. Right at the...
Okay. We're going to keep going with this?
I usually have longer-ish fingernails. And working in retail, I have literally had them ripped under. Yeah. Oh. I can feel his pain.
Oh.
Yeah, it sucks.
This podcast just got scarier than the movie.
I know.
For sure, yeah.
Hey, I can give you a lot of injuries that I have sustained over.
Please don't.
And that's for another day.
37 years of living, I am very graceful.
Another podcast.
I figured out why we have 3-hour episodes. It's not our guests.
It's me.
We're shooting for one today, right? 3 hours?
No!
I admit it.
Arc of 3 hours.
Listen, we got to look at the well-being of our guests here, okay?
I have to feed on
not well.
I have to feed on the guests.
I haven't been well for a very long time. When did we start this podcast? That's pretty much when my health declined.
Oh, damn. Now
that's what we do.
Stop talking.
Oh, no, stop it.
I've gone up 3 pant sizes because of this podcast, all right?
Zip it, lock it, put it in your pocket. There we go. That's me.
Okay. I know. Let's take the only female on the show and make her feel bad.
Every time.
Every time.
I'm outnumbered.
It's a total
beautiful,
sauce.
Babe.
I need to find. So the sheriff shows up again because Aaron comes back and she's freaking out. You know, somebody's attacking him. And so the sheriff shows up. And of course, he's trying to keep them there. So he's got to find something to keep them there. So he finds the roach. And
somebody's smoking the gun, smoking the doobie. Like,
I just love that Morgan's back, like, it's not mine, man.
We're gonna stand here while you smoke the
whole thing. This is in our van. Then why are you in it?
You can smoke 2 pounds of marijuana. I'm going to learn you a lesson.
All I can think of is Super Troopers.
That's exactly it. Mother of God.
So we then see Leatherface packaging up Andy's stump with some salt.
Oh, dude.
He just scoops that bag good. Of salt and just
got out.
And the butcher like, paper.
No. Yep.
Oh, good. Yep. He did that.
So we then go back and Hoyt is looking through the van. He's got the three of them in the dirt, and then he takes Morgan and he interrogates him to pretty much be like, "Hey, how did she do it? How did she kill herself?" And so he's got to go through the whole thing of putting the gun in his mouth and sitting in the exact spot. I don't know, the one where he look down, he's like moving like parts of her brain and stuff. And stuff. Also, when they were shooting this, he like forced himself to throw up like multiple times for putting the gun like too deep in his mouth. Yeah.
Just didn't have that callus built up.
Well, I guess it was also just kind of the reaction too, to get him to like, you know, because he's crying and like sweaty and he's going through it.
He sells getting his fucking ass beat in this movie, dude. Yep. This dude just plays Morgan. Like, he is like through the shit emotionally and physically.
I think the great thing about like Arlie Ermey's performance is the fact that he's so like, he's not yelling at him all the time. He's like just asking him questions, but like it's terrifying even when he's calmly doing it.
Intimidating.
Yeah. And then like when he doesn't do it, that's when he like, you know, put the gun in your fucking mouth type thing. And you're like, oh,
he has a presence to him that you can't, no matter what you say to this guy, he's got something coming back to you. So he just beats you down to a degree that you can't recover from.
All three of them on the ground and just like the snot that's in the dirt and they're crying, especially I think it's Piper Pepper, whatever her name is, like Pepper. The middle girl. Like she, like the shots of her just crying, it's like, ew, this is quite uncomfortable.
Good. It's really good acting, which is shocking for, you know, a movie like this where you don't get like the best performances because they're usually just the cannon fodder.
Except for
if it was like the final girl is usually your best performer. But to be honest, I feel like the performances in this movie are actually really good.
Yeah.
Secondary characters act better than the main characters.
In some movies. But no, I agree.
About this movie.
Oh. Yeah, I think whoever did.
Oh, yes. If we're talking about Aaron compared to everybody else.
Yeah.
Aaron was the looker. All right. Aaron was the one you were just looking at most of the time.
I liked looking at Aaron. Yes. Just didn't appreciate it. Please continue.
So we're back at the house. And this is where we see Leatherface doing, like, sewing up a new face. And then that's how you determine that Kemper is fully dead, because he's sewing up his face. And this
even got the little chin,
and the little hair down there. Yeah,
a little hair on the chin there.
And this is the first time you see Leatherface's actual face in any Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie. Which in the original, in the beginning, you find out. Well, you find it out in this movie too, the fact that he has a skin disease. But in the beginning, he is born, and of course he's like, because he has this disease, he doesn't look very pleasant, and so he's kind of abandoned at the meat factory you see later. Mm-hmm. And so the Hewitts take him in, so he's technically not their actual child. So
dude, listen, the only thing I thought of is, if the ladies can't find you handsome, they can at least find you handy. And he is. Mm-hmm.
That's very true.
You know, chop up meat and shit. He knows what he's doing. He's a resourceful man.
Well, that's the thing, is he grows up working in that meat factory. And
that's
why he's so handy. Yeah.
That's what I thought, because there's scenes later. I was like, there's no fucking way he'd know about this stuff unless he's worked at this factory. So that makes
sense. He knows how to cut a ribeye beautifully, let me tell you.
Yeah, that's right.
But like, good marble. I don't know. The mystery of never seeing his face is what I like. And then they show his face. I'm like, oh, like, he just looks like Skeletor.
Come on, beast man.
So I forgot to mention that Morgan gets taken away by the sheriff. So we then see the sheriff with Morgan in the back, and you know, they're talking like, hey, where were you going? You know, where were you? It was like Dallas, you know, we're going to a front row at a Skinner concert. He's like, oh, well, that sucks. You ain't going to that now. And he's like, what are you going to do with those tickets? He's like, you can have them. And then he just takes the bottle of liquor and just smashes him in the face.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Like, that was rude, wasn't it?
Yeah. He's just spitting out tea.
Totally.
Oh, dude, it was so good, man. Yeah. And he never yelled. Not at once. He just turns around and fucking cracks him with that bottle.
Oh, I also forgot to mention that when he's demonstrating how the girl, you know, kills herself, he turns the gun on the sheriff. And
yeah,
he was going to shoot him. And he pulls the trigger. There's nothing in there.
We all wanted that to happen.
Oh, yeah. We were all Pepper. Don't shoot him!
Away, turn around and shoot the motherfucker. Yeah. And guess what? No more bullets.
Yep. And then I was like, looks like we got a goddamn killer on our hands.
Well, given the situation, I mean, you don't know any of these people's background, and it's dark in there. And, like, you really can't tell what's in those chambers. Like, are the round shots?
Also, he's in such distress.
Exactly.
I don't think he was looking at that like, all right, I see three in the chamber there. Yeah.
Does he know anything about guns?
Exactly.
He just knows he has one.
Yeah, that's...
And he's...
Yeah.
The way it's shot, too, is we as audience don't really know if there's any ammo in there either.
Yeah.
It's in shadow. But one of the coolest things I saw in that one scene was while I'm paying attention to that, it would flip and show Arlie Ermey's face. His eyes are almost black at the same time.
Yeah.
So it's this very dark, gritty part, this, you know, just insane. And Aaron and everyone yelling in the background, the tension just gets built and built and built.
Yeah.
And yet again, something else to blame Aaron on is don't shoot him. And everyone else is like, shoot him. Yeah. Shoot him now. He's a bad guy.
Yeah.
And once again, she's like, don't do it. Don't do it.
Because her decision making, it's like she thought he was the actual sheriff and like they were just going to get in more trouble. It's like, what has he done to really put that signal in your head that like that this seems legit.
This is normal sheriff stuff.
Yeah, what? Like, I understand you're in a back road town with usually one, you know, I grew up in a town similar to this where there was one cop and he probably wasn't even full time. Like he was just there if there was an emergency. So it's understandable that maybe, you know, things can happen that no one's ever going to find out about.
Country justice.
Yeah, but it's like, come on, man. Like,
how
this dude just wrapped a body up
in
freaking saran wrap.
Red flags.
Yeah.
Exactly. Like, there's so many red flags
it's tough.
This guy throws up. It's like,
smacking you in the face left and right. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember the original being so red flaggy. Is that a word? I don't even know. I think they got dropped into the situation and they couldn't get out, where these kids had multiple opportunities to get the hell out of Dodge.
In a Dodge,
any of this
ironically.
Happened.
Carry on. I'm sorry. It's an old Dodge flat nose. I'm sorry. I noticed
That's like you had ample opportunity, and I understand that if you get out of Dodge, you don't have a movie. I totally get that. But when it's so very easy to say, don't go upstairs, leave the front house, you know, go out the front door and run to your neighbors or something like that. This was so frustrating because, once again, you had enough opportunity to get out of there and they neglected to do that. They listened to some ding dong.
To Aaron's credit, though, before the sheriff showed up, she was trying to start that van and get like she was literally trying to just be like, we're getting out of here, we'll figure it out after the fact.
I'll go ahead. Sorry, Charlie, go ahead.
No, I was just saying that, you know, for every option that they've had to leave, they had 100 of them, it seems. Mm. But there was a point where she was like, fuck it, we got to go. There's, you know, we'll figure this out later.
Yeah, and Morgan even tried to leave earlier, and she wouldn't give him the keys.
Right?
Yeah, she had them in a pocket and everything.
When they went to
the
graveyard, the car graveyard.
She knew 100% they were going to leave. And to be honest, I wouldn't have blamed him. Like you were making the most illogical decisions ever. Mm-hmm. Like, we'll maybe come back if we can get some help. and try to see what's going on. But like, to be honest, I don't want to die. Like, I feel like we're just going down a dark path. Like, Morgan knew what was going to happen before it happened.
Yeah. It makes me wonder, because there's a part to this movie that they eliminated, was the fact that Erin was supposed to be pregnant.
Yeah.
Because her and Kemper had been together for 3 years. Oh. So if that had been left in, I would have probably been more understandable of her reluctance to just cut bait and leave.
Abandon her baby daddy.
Exactly. Yeah. Abandon the, you know, the guy she, because all we get in this is that he was going to propose to her. That's our only like emotional connection to the two of them. But had they left that fact, you know, because she says, you know, she doesn't smoke the weed, she didn't drink the water in Mexico, that would have been just something good, just a little thing to throw left in there to say she was pregnant this whole time, and this is, you know, she's being protective of Kemper, and you know, she's trying to protect everyone else too, but it just seems like her decisions are the reason why that's 90% of this shit's happening.
That's also a little unrealistic in the 70s. Like, he still smoked and drank when they were pregnant.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah. No, I mean, not all of them, but I'm sure a lot of them did. But they're also trying to paint her off.
The vast majority did.
Yeah, but
there's no repercussions.
As the innocent in this one, she has, the final girl has to be the innocent one. You know, so she has to be the one that didn't partake in any of this stuff. Yeah. And it's fine. It's just they could have done it a little bit better.
This just made me realize that means he was going to propose like maybe during the middle of the bitchin' guitar solo in Freebird.
Yeah. Hell yeah. That's the best time.
This is the most romantic thing ever, baby. You know what? Simple man's plan. I want you to be my simple man.
Be your simple man. That's what
one of these days I'll tell you how I proposed to my wife. So it's hilarious, but I won't tonight.
Oh man. So
where are we in this movie?
We're getting there. So Erin gets since they left, Erin and Pepper are alone, and so Erin hotwires the van to leave, but when they start to drive away, all the tires just fall off. And they crash.
Yep.
And of course,
that's right.
The sheriff called to send Leatherface to them. So, of course, he shows up at that time to attack. And this thing is able to, he's able to chainsaw through this van like it's nothing.
Yep.
I love it. My wife, it's so much fun watching these movies with my wife, because she points out the things that just, they make me laugh. Like, she's laughing this entire scene because she's like, it's really able to do that so easily. But then you get to a later scene where he can barely cut through something that seems easier to cut with a chainsaw.
Like a wooden door.
Yeah. He's like, right? Why is this? Or like a couch. They move a couch in front of a door. It's like
on the table. Yeah.
So
the consistency of matter doesn't really work in this movie. Chainsaw doesn't cut through some metals, but others. But yet, it'll slice through a leg with no give.
Oh, yeah,
quick.
Then she can slice an arm off later that never even got through the bone. You know, it's just like, whoop, oh, his arm's gone now.
Yeah, three hacks with a butcher knife and bye.
That's all it takes.
Exactly.
She hit that one spot where the bone just wasn't connected to the other.
Yep.
It was an old break he had. It never healed right.
Yeah. Damn it, woman. My one weakness. And it just
Oh, no. Not a kitchen knife.
It's just like the scene from, from Monty Python and the Holy Grail. You know, the scene where the knight loses all of his limbs.
Yeah.
Where it's just like, bam. Worse. It's just one touch and like the arm falls off. Yeah.
His butt a scratch.
Yes.
So, yeah, they get attacked by Leatherface. Pepper gets killed. I do like the shot where the headlights are shining on him, and she's wearing like a jacket filled with feathers. So when he kills her, the feathers explode, and then he turns and he's wearing her wearing Kemper's face. I really wanted a better reaction from her, because I don't know, like, her reaction just seemed like she was just terrified, and not just the fact that like she sees her boyfriend's face.
Like, she took like 2 seconds to think about it.
Like, that was so disappointing.
Yeah.
Like,
maybe she was thinking that her boyfriend was killing their friends.
That's clearly your boyfriend's face.
But also, when we first meet Leatherface, he wears his you know, the leather face mask. And then he switches to this one. And this is the only scene he wears it in. He goes back to his OG mask for the rest of the movie.
Maybe didn't think it was properly good. In that one.
Yeah, he couldn't breathe. He's like, I forgot to slit the hole in the mouth.
He wasn't feeling it.
You don't have to worry about shaving twice.
He's like, I'm way too pretty now. Right. I can't do this.
Yeah. He forgot to put the lotion on the skin.
He did. Try it out.
Another character based on Ed Gein.
He's true.
Mm-hmm. So Erin, of course, is all alone now. She is the final girl. And she runs through the woods and she finds a trailer who has two people, Henrietta, a sickly woman, and the tea lady, which is literally what her name is in the credits. And, you know, they're pretending to be helpful. There's a baby there also. And Erin finds out that the baby is not theirs. It is taken from a family that, I'm guessing, disappeared and were killed by Leatherface and the family.
Victim of the Sawyer family.
Or the Hewitts. Yep.
Not Sawyer. Thank you.
You get the whole thing where she asks to use a phone. They say they don't have one, but then she finds out they do because Henrietta's calling, I'm guessing, the grandmother, who is the woman from the general store from earlier. Yeah. And she gets drugged from the tea. And she wakes
don't
up.
Drink the
tea. Yeah, don't drink the tea. She was like forcing in her mouth, though. She's like, drink the fucking tea. Come on, put it in your mouth. And she wakes up and she is. I was expecting the dinner scene from the original. I thought they were going to remake the dinner scene.
That's what I thought.
From the original.
Was
but we didn't. Mm-hmm. We just got her in the living room and you got Sheriff Hoyt, no pants on. Just sitting there pouring beer in her unconscious mouth.
It's been a long day of work. You don't wear pants after a long day of work.
I'm not wearing pants now.
And you,
same.
Yeah. You kind of find out who everybody is in this family. So the woman at the general store, as we stated, is the mother of Sheriff Hoyt and Leatherface, who is named Thomas. And then you have Uncle Monty. And then you got Jedediah, who I don't know. He's a grandson because he comes like, Grandma, can I come in now? It's my favorite thing because it reminds me of Talladega Nights. Shut up, Grandpa.
You'll sleep out there with the dogs until you learn to play along.
It's going to kick you in the back of the head, Chip.
To be honest, it reminds me of that scene from Holes. Was it the little girls? The little girl who like yells at her grandpa. That's too goddamn bad.
Oh yeah.
I'm tired of digging, Grandpa.
So she is dragged to she's thrown in the basement. She finds Andy there. He's hanging from the meat hook. And of course they gotta make it very eerie because he's got his toes playing on the piano. And she's trying to get him off the hook. She can't. And so he's like, well, you got to end it. And so she gets a knife and she stabs him in the stomach.
The slowest way to kill someone. The slowest way to kill someone.
Let's make this the worst painful death ever.
And personal.
We're going to try to lift you off the meat hook and then let the meat hook dig further into your back. Mm-hmm. And then I'm just going to stab you in the stomach.
Yeah.
That I'm a terrible friend.
Because he tries to get himself off the meat hook.
Yeah.
And it happens. And then she does it. He's like, stop, dude. Just fucking stop.
I'm concerned as to why she didn't just climb on the back of the piano.
And try to lift him up that way?
And lift him up that way.
And then just like, she goes around back. Piano. I'm going to lift you. What's his name, Andy?
Because this movie is stupid. So that's why she didn't do that.
So she gets around the back. It's like, I'm going to help you lift him up and like get you off the weight. But when she does, she gets him off. She like grabs him around the waist, right, and starts lifting and gets the hook gets out of his back, and then fucking suplexes him off the back of the piano.
Just
fucking donezo, and the movie just ends.
She gets up in his face.
Yes,
Leatherface walks in. He's just like,
he comes in with the fucking chair. Boom, Leatherface and shit. He's like,
no, he just comes in. He's just like, he's just like mad respect. Like palms are up and just lets her leave, and that's the end. It just reminds me of one of the later Texas Chainsaw Massacres. Go get him, cuz. I'm like, what is this movie? Oh, man. So she finds Morgan And he looks like he just got off a meat hook because he's got a hole in his back. So I'm guessing that's what it was from.
Yeah.
And he's in rough shape. So she drags him out of there. Leatherface is watching on. Kind of reminds me of the remake of Psycho. Like, I'm wondering what he's doing to himself as he's watching on. I'm like, hopefully not that.
Do you think, because when Erin got thrown downstairs to begin with, she was being unruly. And the mom hollered for Thomas. Yeah. Leatherface. Do you think he was in the middle of processing him and he had to stop? Because he's just sitting in the tub.
And yeah, that's where he took
care of other dude, chiseled motherfucker from the beginning.
That's a nice way to say I'm chopping up a dude to make meat out of him.
I'm just saying. I mean,
so I think
I'm trying to be polite.
So Leatherface in this movie is a little inconsistent. So he in the original,
tell me more.
Here I go. Well, in the original, he is very shy, and he's like, he's afraid of everybody in the family. Like, you know, in the original, it's his brother, right?
Yeah,
who is like the one who's always like threatening to beat him up, and he like cowers all the time. And even when he is Leatherface doing the Leatherface things, like chasing people around with chainsaws, he doesn't seem as brooding. Like, he's scary, but he's not as, I feel like his confidence is like at an all time high in this one, where like he is walking around, like his chest is out. He's got that chainsaw and he is confident. He's like, I will fuck anybody up, even my family. But then there's the scene where you meet the entire family after Erin wakes up and he's cowering behind the wall as she's talking about him. Because she's talking about how the fact that, like, he's been bullied all his life and, you know, nobody treats my Thomas very dead, you know, like everybody, you know, and he's over there like.
It's probably one of those things where it's like, hey, you don't fuck with anybody in your family, but you do anything possible to protect the family, or you do what the family says kind of thing. It's all indoctrination anyway. It's just how you're raised, you know.
Right. And it's also the family's probably the ones that are the biggest bullies to him.
Yeah, exactly.
Directly.
Yeah,
right. Even though they speak of family and protect one another, they're probably the biggest abusers mentally to him. Mm-hmm.
Well,
I agree. I think it's totally inconsistent with how he's depicted throughout most of the movie. Then all of a sudden, we got to get this childlike version of him. You know,
exactly.
To me, it doesn't work that great. Yeah,
and I think the problem
he wasn't childlike at the beginning of the movie, and he reverts, or it's just all of a sudden that side of his personality comes out. It doesn't make a lot of sense.
No, it doesn't. And I wonder if whether it includes Jedi or whatever that kid's name is, like, just take him out because he's supposed to be like the abused little kid. And just put that back into Leatherface, because that's what he's supposed to be.
Right, right. Make indoctrinate and mm-hmm.
Yeah, like just abuse.
You need
I like that a lot.
You need that plot device of how she gets out of the house. How, you know, who's the one that helps her get away instead of just so happening finding a door. Even though it's a little janky the way they do it with Jedediah. You know, because it's like this, you know, this is like the second or third person he's helped escape. Because they say, you know, he helped that last girl escape. That's why he's not allowed to come inside. He's not allowed to play anymore. And now he's just let technically two get away again. You know, it's like, well, be a little more consistent in your character development.
Right. Part of the Leatherface monster is that he has. So Dracula has a weakness. So does Frankenstein to a degree. So do a lot of monsters. And unlike Jason, and maybe unlike Michael Myers, Leatherface he's a child overall. And if you can play on that, that is his weakness. And you can escape from him. If you can leverage that childlike personality in him, and that's his weakness. I mean, he's human. He's not supernatural at all whatsoever. You can kill him with a shotgun if you had one at that point. But to distract him enough so that you can escape, you can play on his infantile brain, or however you want to describe it, his I don't have words for it, but it's That is his weakness. That makes monsters real to me, where you have a silver bullet or a cross or daylight, or if it is an unstoppable monster, I get to check out because it's not real enough to me. But with Leatherface, in the early goings on, you could appease his youthfulness, his undeveloped brain, and get away from him. And now I've just lost all of what I was going to talk
about. I think what you're trying to say is that Leatherface
and have another beer. Hang on.
And Robin Williams from Jack have a lot in common.
Wow, what a connection.
There you go.
That's what you're going for, right?
Wow.
Well,
I like a weakness in my monsters. Like with zombies, there is no weakness in a zombie. They just
shoot it in the head.
Come yeah, it's and fire. Eat everything in the.
No, the brain.
Well, I'm sorry?
Get rid of it. That's how you shoot it in the head. Weakness.
Have you not seen Return of the Living Dead? That doesn't matter.
He would not survive a zombie apocalypse, all we're learning right now. Doesn't know how to shoot him in the head.
Bonk him on the head.
I'm saying is I really liked that you could have talked to Leatherface and tried to get away from him, and you might have succeeded if you didn't have backup with the family.
Well, that's what they did in part two. That's I forget the girl's name, the disc jockey. She plays into that. Rich. She does it more on the sexual side. Yeah, but it's still kind of the same concept of tapping into that psyche that he has, and that is kind of his only weakness. It's just this movie isn't smart enough to do that.
No, it doesn't play into that weakness. It doesn't play. The thing that we see in the original, and to your point, is the fact that like Leatherface is a child. He is a big child. He is, you know, he has some sort of
his brain is underdeveloped.
Yeah, and so he has those childlike tendencies. But he is still this massive hulking man who can murder people. Where this one doesn't play into
just
it because
like
you
Robin
don't.
Williams.
Yes, in Jack.
Yes,
he murders people. I'm sorry.
No, but he tries to get in with Jennifer Lopez, and who wouldn't want to do that?
I mean, not forcibly, but
no.
If I had an opportunity,
Angela, don't lie.
She's casually drinking here, just gets
Angela
pulled.
I saw her raise her hand.
He said, "Don't lie."
I'm... Like not me.
No.
But no, this Leatherface just seems a lot smarter. Like you can tell, especially when that scene where we're getting into the fact that when she runs into the meatpacking plant and they're playing that cat and mouse game. And she's hiding in the lockers, and like he's not stupid. Like, you know, he's.
I don't think he's consistently smart or stupid, though.
Yeah.
In this movie,
I just don't see. I think one of my biggest complaints is the fact that you don't really see enough of him with his family, enough of an interaction with them. You get this. I don't even think the only like true interaction is like when Uncle Monty calls him from his room when he's, you know, confronting Andy. Like, that's about it. You don't really see. In the beginning, you do see more of that family dynamic of Thomas and the rest of the family kind of working together to then set up for this movie. But this Leatherface is very different than the Leatherface we see in the original.
And this is the analog. I'm going to use a couple analogies for this for folks that have not seen the original, but maybe more in the modern horror content. You guys may follow along with this. Of course, you get the dinner scene in the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which kind of illustrates where people stand, you know, Leatherface in the makeup and all that stuff, acting like the female role as well.
Patriarchy, yeah.
Yes, but then this also makes me think of the dinner scene in the beginning of Resident Evil 7, for those of you that have played those games, where have you played Resident Evil 7?
I did play the beginning part, and I got scared.
Yeah, it's when you get the, oh, dude, it's fucking creepy as shit. It's during like where you're forced to eat the food with the bakers, and then like it's the mom and the dad talking and the shit ass kid arguing. He fucking stabs that thing through his hand and shit. It's that whole thing where you get dynamic of these characters, how they interact. They're not just bad guys and, you know, doing stuff. They actually have a dynamic of how they act and, like you said, sets the hierarchy. But Resident Evil 8 does the same thing. Have you ever played Resident Evil 8? Anybody here?
Have it.
No.
Dude, there's a great scene where all the villains are fucking together and it just sets this wonderful hierarchy, and it's one of my favorite scenes in a Resident Evil game, and that's what this is missing. This movie is missing.
Yeah.
So.
I agree.
Sets up the totem pole, man. It's fucking awesome.
To me,
awesome.
Like, this movie uses too much Leatherface compared to the original.
Yeah, like, once you get to
so much focus on the family, yeah. Like he's kind of a side character. He's just so memorable.
The family is so important to the story. Where it's
why
it's,
the 2022
shouldn't
didn't
be just
work.
About Leatherface. It's about the whole the terror is the scary
whole shish kebab
family. Right. It's not just a dude. It's the whole family.
Yeah. So Jedediah helps him escape. They find a little cabin in the woods and they hide from Leatherface and he finds them and Morgan sacrifices himself to save her. This scene was also supposed to be a lot more gory. You were supposed to see like the whole part of him actually cutting up from his crotch throughout his entire body. Yeah.
Terrifier 1, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like, why is this? Okay, I get it. Like, I'm not in this situation, but I hate this in movies. This is, again, Jurassic Park Lost World, the snake thing. Why is it when you're in facing imminent death and going to die and you're concerned about the fucking rats around you? Why is,
I don't know.
This animal that's a minor inconvenience, but I have another human that's fairly intelligent that will fucking kill me. Like I said, this is what, I'm a huge, you know, I get fears. I have dumb, irrational fears, but I love spiders and insects and stuff like that. Love them to death. And it just, like, people are like, oh, God, the spider, this is so scary. I'm like, oh, that thing, that minor inconvenience, that 99% will do nothing to you, but you'll fucking crush it and end its life, but you're concerned about that. Like, that's what bothers me. Like, I'm scared of rats. Mouse touches me. Like, what if a mouse touches you? You're just going to kill it. How is that a fair trade? But you're like, I'm not concerned about this man with this chainsaw because there's a fucking rodent on me. Oh,
but
Christ.
You keep yourself away from passing out from not breathing when these are good-sized rats.
I know. It's supposed to add. And rats don't bother me either.
I would hold my breath until I literally passed out and I'd have given myself away.
There you go. But I'm the guy that's like, I don't like heights. Like, I get up too high on a ladder and I'm like, I'm concerned. And like, people are like, you fucking pussy. And like, I'm sorry. I get it. But anyway. I just hate stuff like this.
It's not the height that's the problem. It's the fall at the end.
It's like
it's not even the fall. It's the landing.
Yeah.
The sudden stop at the bottom.
Just sudden stop. Don't worry, guys. My neck will break my fall. It's fine.
Yeah.
So Leatherface chases her, and they are going through like a barbed wire fence, and he trips and slices his leg open. A callback to the original. It's cool, but he don't limp at all. He's moving around pretty good for the rest of the movie. Like he doesn't just almost cut his leg off, but he gets into the meatpacking plant.
Sever a major artery, you know.
Yeah, they go into the meatpacking plant. They have their cat and mouse game. She hides in a locker. Well, actually, we go into the meat locker first, which most of the meat locker actually had actual cow carcasses because they couldn't afford to make them all on purpose. Like,
oh,
make
really?
Them all practical is what I meant to say.
Oh,
and
all like real.
Like, there were a lot of them was actual like cow carcasses. Yeah. Cool. And Jessica Biel is a longtime vegan.
Oh,
so I guess
really?
It was really rough for her. Yeah.
I believe it.
Just have to turn to the face that she faces, the little cow face, and be like, hello.
So
they don't have faces at that time.
Well, there was the ones that were hanging up that heads. There were a few that were just like heads. They have
prostate. Oh, I missed that. Okay.
But speaking of people not walking with injuries, right? So we're talking about Leatherface not walking, like not showing like issues having cut his leg. Well, fucking lady at the beginning, you know, she had a fairly good sized revolver stuffed in her human creation station. Nobody said nothing about that. So like she didn't have like an odd gait about it.
We gotta rewatch the scene where she's walking down the street and she's like walking. Like,
she's got like a weird walk and she can't sneeze.
I swear, I was like, you can't see. You're gonna drop the gun or shit your pants. Yeah. It's one of the two.
Also, there's a scene where Aaron
shoots yourself from there.
This is coming out.
Just get all three of them.
There's also a scene where Aaron falls from a pretty high, like distance, and she like falls and like hurts her leg and she's like grabbing at her leg and like, ah, and then immediately gets up and just runs.
I'm good.
It's fine.
Yeah,
it's fine.
Okay, cool.
Walk it off.
Adrenaline's a hell of a drug.
It man. Really is.
It's true. This is true.
I know that so, for a fact.
She hides in the locker. And this is where you get like the, you know, him checking all the lockers and he thinks he knows where she is, but he opens it up and it's a pig. And she for comes sure. out with her her butcher knife and just
meat cleaver.
In the most like she's not even full swing. She's just this is her motion right now.
It's embarrassingly girly is what she's doing. I mean, there is no girl in the world that wouldn't roundhouse whack this dude.
Yeah.
But she's like,
yeah, I agree.
Even with the very mediocre hits to his arm, you know, I love Leatherface's reaction to his arm being chopped off, like him screaming and then him trying to pick up his arm as it's spinning around with the chainsaw.
Yes, that's, the one
that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool.
And then instead of him continuing, like he's done.
He just falls over
and he's literally holding his other arm and he's just whimpering. And
it doesn't
you're
glue
like,
back in.
And you're so like, nice. This is it. Is this, this is like, yeah, this was my, like my job was to, my life's work was sewing faces. Now I can't, I only have one arm. I'm going to have to learn how to drum like the drummer of Def Leppard now.
You'll figure it out.
You can still sew with one hand. Def Leppard.
Yeah, you can. Yep. So she then goes back to the road and we kind of get a recreation of the final scene of the original where a truck driver pulls up, finds her. And of course she's very much like the hitchhiker from the beginning where he's asking her questions and she's just kind of mumbling or she's just like, you know, yeah, I got to get away. I just want to go home. And then of course he drives into the town and she freaks out and almost crashes the truck, but he stops right in front of the general store where the sheriff, the mom or the grandma, Henrietta and the baby are, I don't know why they're here. I was kind of confused why they all just decided
family gathering.
Let's go hang out at the general store. Okay. and so she runs out and he goes in there to tell like, oh yeah, I picked up this woman. She seemed in distress. I just, you know, can you check it out? So the sheriff goes out there and you kind of get the like, where is she right now? Because it looks like she's in the truck. And so the sheriff's slowly going up to the truck to see, but she's not. She's actually hot wiring his police car. And she also stole the baby. And she fucks Sheriff Hoyt up. She runs him over like three or four times. He's great, done, dude. And
it's very satisfying.
Yes.
Sure.
Yes.
Yes. Like, he is that character. Yeah. You wanted to see die more than anyone else in this movie, even more than Leatherface.
Even though Leatherface is the villain, like I never like thought like, man, I can't wait till Leatherface dies.
When you watch this like, movie, like... Leatherface to me never was the number one villain. It was always Sheriff Hoyt. Sheriff Hoyt was the mastermind behind everything that happened, in my opinion. I feel like the grandma probably was, but Sheriff Hoyt was the mastermind.
Brilliant casting on their part.
Oh, absolutely.
Though.
Yeah. Oh God, yeah.
And to be honest, he is. I feel a good reason to check out the prequel because he does
honestly
return,
yeah.
So.
All right.
And
not gonna do it.
It's fine. You're not gonna get much out of it. It's just kind of how everybody gets shit. So yeah, she drives down the road and you get the one final hoorah from Leatherface as he swings his one arm around and you know hits the side of the car and.
I think it was funny. He swung his arm, grabs his arm attached to the other chainsaw and like swings it. He's clearly holding his arm, holding right. the other chainsaw.
He couldn't get the fingers.
Now I'm
loose.
Down for that movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I can't wait till they do a sequel to this. Like they did. Eventually they'll do one. It's going to be a long time from now. It's going to be a sequel to this directly to this movie. Like they did the first one where the second one of that was kind of a comedy, but this is going to be a horror musical. And it's
they're doing it with Joker.
He has to do one.
I might be down with that.
Yeah,
it's a robot arm because that
one was cut off. The musical. Yeah, I'm
even. No, it's gonna be a love story, and it's like even leather can find love. Yeah, that's gonna be the tagline.
Rock opera.
He's gonna date his sister because he's in Texas.
No dialogue, just singing.
The final scene of this movie.
He's never hated anything in his life.
It's just a Texas Phantom of the Opera. That's all it is.
So the final shot of this movie is the end of the black and white police video that you see in the beginning, yeah. Where the cop goes down and investigates, and then he ends up getting attacked by Leatherface. And then it shows like their funeral and all that, and the fact that they never found him. They never found Leatherface. And yeah, that's it. That is the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2003. Yes, Dan?
I'm going to raise my hand because I literally just had a huge epiphany moment. Talking about Phantom of the Opera in Texas, is there a movie called Phantom of the Opry? Is that a thing?
There is a movie called
The Grand Ole Opry, like, is not in Mall? Texas.
Yeah, but we've already had all these. How come there's not like a country music-based Phantom of the Opera?
Grand Ole Opry's in Tennessee.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be in Texas. It just hit me. It could be anywhere. Yeah, why isn't there a Phantom of the Opera? Yeah, why isn't that a thing? So I'm going to use that idea. Just give me credit. Like, I don't want any money. Just like, hey, that guy gave the idea. Like, that's all I want.
Bad ideas.
I think it's a good idea.
All right.
I'm not going to watch it.
It's the sequel to Bubba Hotep. Is the
sure, why not?
Grand Ole Opry.
Please. I don't even like, I don't listen to country music. It's not my music, but it just seems like an idea. Well, why not? We have bad CGI shark or fucking house shark or sand shark or, you know.
Yeah, why can't we have this?
House shark didn't suck, let me tell you. Ouija shark sucked. Sharkula sucked.
Sharkula, yes, thank you.
That was bad.
Arkansas. Yeah.
Arkansas Women's Prison Massacre, baby.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that. Well,
we covered it.
Directed by the guy who directed Chopping Mall.
Yeah, he did. Yes.
Whoa. I don't totally need to see it. I'm embarrassed that I haven't.
I hate
it.
To bust bubbles here, but there was a Phantom of the Opry
Shit.
TV series in 1983 through 1985.
Damn it! Yep. Remake it.
In Nashville, so it was Tennessee. But yeah, apparently there is a whole thing about Phantom of the Opry.
Well, thank you for finding that out. I appreciate it.
Star. What's her face?
Dolly Parton?
Dolly Parton, yeah.
Maybe.
Don't see any pictures of Dolly. This is still fairly early. But...
She, at worst, she needs to make an appearance in Phantom of the Opry.
Please, make it happen. They've got an all Opry right. in Pigeon Forge. They can just do it over there. And she can bring her in.
With a special guest appearance from Elvira. That would be awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah. There we go.
I love you, Cassandra
Peterson.
All the
boobies.
With all my heart and soul. All the boobies.
All of them.
Because everybody loves boobies. Hey, where are we going tonight?
All right. Well,
now it is
time to share our final thoughts on this movie. And
sure I know where two of them are
of
going.
Of course, we're going to start with our guests. And who wants to start over here?
Nate.
Me.
Rock, paper, scissors.
It was funny, like, every time we watch something, I'm like, oh, this is going to be like the hardest movie to cover. I don't know why I always do that to myself. Revisiting this for 20 years and being like, all right, we're going to go in not being angsty teenager.
My God, this is 20 years old. Jesus.
Yep.
Yeah, it is.
Yep. Partially why I picked it.
But like, God. To me, the movie is trying too hard to be dirty because it seems so sanitized to me. And a lot of it is, it feels like a CW movie just set in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre universe. So it still does not click for me. I'm glad to have revisited it just to finally give it another whirl. And like the best analogy I can come up with it for, like, it's like deathcore, which is just really shitty music and tries too hard to do what old school death metal does with being grimy and dirty and authentic. And this doesn't feel authentic to me. So that's my problem with it. It just doesn't feel, it feels like it's there to make money and that's it. And the dirtiness that I get from the original one, especially after rewatching the original, that 4K release that came out and just seeing how gorgeous those shots are and just how gross that movie is. I don't feel that grossness from here. Like I said, too much Leatherface. If it wasn't for having Ermy in this role, this movie would not be anything to remember. And like I said, like Pete and I were saying, the first 20 minutes, I'm still into it. But like once it starts to get to the kills I see a guy's leg getting chopped off. It's like, I don't want to see that in my Texas Chainsaw
it was a fun
massacre movie. Yeah, like, it's just, I don't, there's nothing to it that is for me, I guess, unfortunately. So, yeah, that's my final thoughts on TCM 2003. But it's still not the worst one in the franchise. If anything, it's like a battle on who could be the worst one in the franchise. I revisited 3 today. It's fucking garbage too.
Why did you do that? You can watch so much other stuff,
dude. I was bored. I was like, all right, I watched this one. I'll watch the beginning. I'll watch part 3. But Viggo Mortensen's very handsome in part 3.
Well, it's Viggo Mortensen.
I mean, yeah. He's got like Leon.
Very young Viggo Mortensen.
Yeah.
If you like, I always got whenever Viggo Mortensen comes up, if you want a good remake of an old car movie, as long as you can do without the drugs, Vanishing Point from the 70s. Have you ever seen that?
Why would I do without the drugs?
I know, right? You don't got the titty girl on the motorcycle either. But anyway, there's a remake with him, Viggo Mortensen, with Vanishing Point. Yeah, it's actually a pretty good movie. It's a lot less druggy, and it's a pretty good show.
Right. All right, Peter Charlie, who's going next? I said what I gotta say.
Okay,
we all know what you're thinking.
First 20 minutes, I'm on board. And then it just goes down this cliff, and I'm bored. This movie bored me. The kills were okay. If this wasn't Texas Chainsaw, it may have piqued my interest. But being Texas Chainsaw and having seen the original years and years ago and being genuinely frightened by it, this missed on all of the hits that was Texas Chainsaw. It was Texas Chainsaw wasn't gory. Texas Chainsaw had a thimbleful of blood in it, but it was still the picture that it drew in your mind made it horrifying. And this just showed you everything, and that's not what I always need. If you want to really fuck with my brain, you don't show anything. For example, the movie Seven didn't show a lot of stuff. It kind of pushed it aside, and you get a flash of it, and that movie to this day disturbs me on a level that I just, my brain just goes crazy with it. And I don't want to see Seven. I don't want to see it. It's
funny that we're using
what's in the
people...
box. I know what's in the fucking box, but I don't want to fucking see it. And I don't see it. And sadly, if I would see it, it would be way easier to digest. And since I don't see it, there it is in my brain pan, just sitting and stewing and making all sorts of awful juice in my brain. This showed things that I didn't want to.
Yeah, it did what most remakes do. It shows you what you didn't see in those originals.
Because it's got
This was the start of the tidal wave of remakes that weren't good. And there are only like three remakes that are really, really. You got Body Snatchers, The Thing, The Fly, and what's the other? There's one more.
Blob.
The Blob.
Yeah.
Those four movies, those remakes are equal to or better than the originals. And I have yet to see something that has been remade that is equal to or better than the original in the 2000s. So
the non-Michael Bay remakes have all
fuck Michael
solid.
Bay. Michael Bay is a hack.
But what I'm saying though is the non-Michael Bay remakes. God damn it, Pete!
What? What are you talking?
I'm talking about the ones that he didn't produce, like this one. So like Maniac or Last House on the
Maniac
Left.
Maniac was not Michael Bay. Maniac was pretty good. That remake was The Strangers. Was
that's
pretty
my
good.
Point. You're making my point here.
Good. Wait, The Strangers was a remake?
There was. I thought was it The Strangers?
I think that was an original idea.
Yeah, that was
the
original.
Well, no. I'm
the crazies.
Sorry.
The crazies was a remake. Yes.
great. There's really a strange. I'm sorry. There was a remake of The Crazies, which wasn't bad. That was a Romero originally, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And then Maniac, which has was it Harry Potter or Frodo? Frodo was in it, right? Pretty fucking good.
Like, there's solid remakes out there for sure. And like we said, even with this one, like if this was your first experience,
big budget,
you're gonna like it.
Movies can go fuck themselves. I have very little time.
Charlie, take away from him.
Please, please. I'm done. He's spiraling right now.
He is. Get him away from it. Stop. He's already dead.
Get to experience what we experience every week.
Sorry.
I'm still trying to wrap my head around something Nate said of, I don't want to see a leg chopped off in a Texas Chainsaw movie.
I don't.
To me,
and other movies I do.
Ridiculous statement I could ever hear, because the reason I get pissed off about watching the original is there is no blood, there is no gore.
That's what makes
you're talking
it
about a movie. It's not terrifying. It is the most boring movie I've watched in a long time.
It's a horrifying movie.
It is not. What's horrifying of the original is how loud it is and how in your face
it is. So biscuit right now.
No, while this movie has its flaws, I love the fact I get gore in it. I love the fact that I finally get to see body parts flying around, you know, legs falling off, arms falling off, a hook in someone's back, and I get to see it try to lift up out of their back. Story-wise, awesome. It's not great. You know, actors, as much as I like to look at Jessica Biel in this movie, she's not the right pick for this movie.
No, she's terrible.
Everyone else is great. Morgan is my favorite character in the entire movie.
The ancillary actors are solid.
Yeah. Arlie Ermey steals it for the most part, yes. So for a remake and for like introducing a new generation to Texas Chainsaw Massacre, this movie's solid.
Do way worse.
Like I have zero issue with this one. I don't want to compare it to the original. As much as I don't like the original, I still would never try to compare it to the original. Give Toby Hooper the money he needed for the original one, there would have been more blood in it. There would have been more production value to it. What we got was based on what budget he had. It just happened to work for some people. But given him the opportunity to just go carte blanche, you would have gotten legs flying. You would have gotten blood and gore and visceral everywhere.
I don't know, because the man-made Poltergeist, that's one of the most scariest movies ever made.
Well, he also made Texas Chainsaw Part 2. You know, he makes Part 2.
Hysterical. Like, Part 2 is my favorite.
But it throws blood. It goes gore.
He made the fun house.
Yeah.
It's everything he wasn't able to do with the first movie, and that's my point. Is if he had just let him do with money, it wouldn't be like, oh, I didn't want to put a ton of blood in this movie. Fuck no, he wanted to put blood in it. He just didn't have the money for it. So, no, I like this one. I like the 03 remake. The rest of the whole series gets just fucking unintelligible to me. It's probably why I like this one more than most, because it's the only one that I can actually sit down, watch, enjoy all the way through. It's a one and done. They don't need sequels. They could just end it. I like 2003, man. It's a good movie.
Angela.
Yeah, you go first this time. I went first earlier.
For watching it the first time, yeah, I enjoyed it. Would I watch it again? Probably not. I got what I needed out of it from the first watch.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. I wish Morgan would have been the final girl.
Oh!
Yeah. Because the whole scene where they're fighting in the house with, you know, the rats and stuff. Why didn't she pick up the chainsaw then? It was in the floor.
Mm-hmm. She was too busy screaming.
She could have picked up the chainsaw and she could have chopped
it. She wouldn't have started. She would have done this number when she tried to start the fucking car.
Yeah,
she would have worked.
There's so many times where things could have happened that Leatherface could have been dead. But anyways.
It's fair.
I liked it. yes, they could have picked different people for different roles, and that probably would have changed it. But
there you go.
That means that's it.
Well said.
There you go.
There's a point in the night where my brain just kind of like
the switch flips
and I'm done.
He understands that completely.
Yep, he totally gets that one.
I've been sick.
Right now the wires are trying to figure out what to say, but they just can't.
Oh, I've been sick this week. I didn't nap today. We've been kind of on the go all weekend. It's just my brain is like, stop.
And she's had to deal with the three of us tonight. So
it's, no.
I'm so sorry about that.
Yeah, that's
I've enjoyed
actually.
All of you.
No, she can just blame me. I invited you guys.
Oh,
no.
That's fair. Yeah.
And she's got to live with Dan. So
that's true.
Yeah, this is the main thing.
Yeah.
How about you, right. Dan?
All right.
Give it to us.
Fuck, you don't even have to ask. Anyway.
Oh, give me it.
Bring it. Give me
the full Dan.
Full Dan. Yes.
All right. Yes, I enjoy this movie. I still like this movie after having not seen it in a while. Like, I've seen it a few times when I was younger when it first came out. But I'm going to pretty much build off what everybody said about Jessica Biel, the secondary characters being better, are good, Arlie Ermey, all that fun stuff. But the thing I like about this movie is you know, compared a lot to the first movie. But this is, I'm kind of glad, even though this is a remake, and they kind of hit on the main points, but they kind of did their own thing. We don't have a Gramps character. Really, we don't have one. It's like, Gramps is the best killer. Let's kill him with a hammer. Like, which, admittedly, it's a creepy part of the first movie, but it's also kind of ridiculous. I love the first movie. I'm not shitting on it anyway. I'm just how I feel about it. There's no brother character, I guess. I mean, Arlie Ermey would be the next closest thing, but it's like this different cast of characters in a similar situation where, again, we don't get the true family dynamic for it. We get like breadcrumbs of it, but it's not built upon properly. And it is Texas Chainsaw Massacre, but it's kind of doing its own thing a little bit. Like I said, it still hits on the key points, but you know, they talk about the cannibalism thing, but it's not really in the movie. Like, even watching it again, it's not like, oh, we cut that guy's leg up, time to fucking eat. Like, it's just you just fill in the blanks, or you imply. No, it's serious. Like, nobody's like, "What's we're gonna eat this guy?" Or that's yeah, good. Let's take a bite of this. It doesn't get brought
never
up.
Never an They never state that they're cannibals.
The
you never
prequel,
see what they are. Yeah,
it's
sure
nonstop in your face that they're cannibals in the prequel.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
Yeah,
so, I've never seen that. I'm just gonna keep this as an isolated.
Yeah, the prequel was kind of like, hey, all the things that we didn't show you in that first one, it's all gonna be in this one.
Yes. And I liked, it almost seems like this movie at times just seems fucking hateful. And I think that kind of works for the time it came out, growing up in the early 2000s. I think this fits that motif of, like, I think it slots perfectly from a 70s movie into an early 2000s movie, you know, essentially 30 years later. And I think it works. I know, I can understand why a lot of people don't like it. I get that 100%, especially nostalgia reasons. I've got that same thing for franchises I love. But I think for what it's trying to do, it works. And I'm not saying it's as good or better than the original. But for what they were trying to do, I think they nailed it. I think we had a decent group of actors that did a pretty good job. And you got some gore. And you got some good tense scenes. And you got some good cinematography. Because there's some great shots of that fucking house.
I don't know.
And especially with night and stuff, with the fog machines and stuff.
That fog rolling over top of the roof. Gorgeous. Yep.
So good.
Yep. And there's some things I didn't like. I thought the running around the butcher house or whatever was a little long. I didn't think it needed to be in the movie at all. Like, we didn't even need that. Right. Like, they could have thought of some other way to make the shit happen that needed to happen.
Yeah.
But even like the Jedi with the kid. I don't remember his name. I don't fucking care. There you go. Thank you. Like, she escaped the original movie without help from anybody. Aaron could have escaped in this one without anybody's help. And I agree. I think Morgan was probably one of the better characters in the movie for being right. But I didn't hate these characters. It's not like a lot of Friday the 13th or slasher movies where you're like just fucking filled with these characters you just fucking hate and can't wait till they die. The villains felt like villains. Well, mainly Arlie Ermey, because the other ones just felt like
they don't really. Yeah, the other ones are just there. They don't.
They're just there. Right. But I like it. It has flaws. I enjoy this movie, and I would watch this movie multiple times into the future. I do like it. It like I said, it does have its flaws, but I do like it.
I'll just say I didn't think you said tints scenes.
Tints? Oh, okay.
I heard something else.
Okay. Just tit scenes?
Tit scenes.
There were no tit scenes in this, so you get no boobage. So sorry, guys.
Just no nudity. Boobies. Yeah, no nudity.
That's really, really very surprising. Close.
Just where really my brain went.
Wet shirt moment, yes. Where you're like, do I see something shirt. Or the, don't I see something?
The original didn't have any nudity in it. Either.
The funniest thing is they're in the movie, you know, you have Jessica Biel with the white shirt, but she's wearing a bra, so you don't see anything, even when she's soaking wet. There are photo edits, like photo stills from this movie where it looks like she's not wearing one. Where it was like, hey guys, this is what Jessica Biel looks like in the movie. And then you see the movie and it's like, no, she doesn't. Stop
fucking
it.
Liars.
Stop it.
You Photoshop nipples.
Liar! Stop playing with my emotions.
Jessica Biel doesn't have nipples.
Come on. Gross.
Mr. Skin lied to me.
What is it? Rule 34? You got to rule 34 everything.
Yeah.
You
rule 34 everything. Yeah. Absolutely.
All right, my final thoughts on this movie.
Jessica Biel doesn't have any nipples.
That's true.
All right, sorry, I apologize.
Watching this again as an adult, I have not seen this movie in probably over a decade. So this is the first time I've seen it as, early 20s, I guess you consider me an adult. But
you're a man now.
I saw the flaws. I've seen all of the rest of the series since then. So I have more of an appreciation for those early Texas Chainsaw movies. I do enjoy the original because of the grittiness and because of like knowing what Tobe Hooper went through to make it. I think since starting the show, I've been able to see certain movies, not just as the movie itself, but everything that happened, you know, behind the scenes. And I think that's why I can appreciate movies that a lot of people don't like. More than I think I probably would have enjoyed them at a younger age. I like that they tried something different. They did the name change. I think having Leatherface be different than his original counterpart, having different type of final characters or having a different group of characters that, to be honest, I like the core group of characters in this compared to the original. But I hate to keep comparing it to the original because I don't feel this is a remake of the original. I feel like it's its own... it's its own movie. It's just a different interpretation of a Texas Chainsaw Massacre story. And I think this is to be honest, to date, I think this is the scariest Leatherface. Even after the most recent rewatch, I think he's brooding. He's terrifying. Every scene you see him in, he's scary. And as I feel the other Leatherfaces are scary, but then you have the very comical versions of the character, where this one is scary from beginning to end, in my opinion. I wish we got the family dynamic a little bit more, but you know what? They were trying something a little bit different, and I can appreciate them for that. I don't care about, you know, you always have to have those characters you just don't give a shit about. Like, why are they here? Like, this is just cannon fodder. I like the fact that we got the girl instead of the brother. Like, that was really cool. The fact that it's a victim and not just somebody luring them to the house to then be slaughtered. There's a lot of good things that I saw from this recent viewing. I like the fact that we get to see more violence in this compared to the original. We get to see like people getting chopped up because it's a dude who kills people with a chainsaw. I want to see him use it. I want to see the gore. Like, I understand that's what movies of that time was all about. It was all about the blood and gore, and it's not what everything I wanted from it, but I could appreciate the fact that like we're seeing this dude getting his leg chopped off. We're seeing this dude hanging from a meat hook and he just looks nasty. And yes, this movie doesn't look as dark and gritty and dirty as, you know, as again, I keep fucking going back to the original, but I feel like you have to at some point, like keep going back and forth with them. But I still enjoy the hell out of this movie. I'll still watch it any chance if it's on TV or if I'm bored and I want to throw it in, this is a Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie I can watch on multiple occasions. Like, I feel like there's other ones that it's just like, I've seen it once, I'm good. I would love to see them do something similar to this one in the future because 2022 just wasn't it for me.
Do you know who couldn't direct that movie?
Michael Bay.
No, Rob Zombie, because it's already about a bunch of Southern Hicks. That,
yeah, he did it was the Devil's Rejects. That's what the Devil's Rejects is.
But yeah, but that whole like his whole like angle, like we'll make him a bunch of like low class, you know, or low income white Americans that beat each other.
They're all in a high rise building in Dallas.
Yeah, that's where it starts. Yeah. Rich it's people enable it.
Collar. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how it starts.
All right, before we get to the very end of the show, we do have some comments. Every week we do post what movie we're covering, and then people you get to comment on your thoughts on the movie. Over on X/Twitter, whatever you want to call it. Our first one is from Ebony or at ebunny061, who just sent me a link to a Ed Gein the Musical on YouTube.
Whoa.
I've heard of that. So go to our post and click on that. I still haven't watched yet. I'm kind of scared. And our next one is from at Eyeball Soup, who said, what are you doing in my house? I ask every time I keep turning to see the Blu-ray sitting on my shelf. All in all, I thought it was a pretty fun, though, with a pretty killer soundtrack. I will add my favorite parts are the black and white hand cam, which that was Nate's favorite part of the movie.
Yeah. Yep.
And I could go for an actual found footage Texas Chainsaw film. That would be dope.
That would be cool.
That would be dope.
I think that's a cool way to go about it.
Like do Blair Witch with Texas Chainsaw. I think that might be pretty cool.
Yeah, but nobody gets killed with a chainsaw.
Seriously,
you don't see any actual cuttings of people. It's all off camera.
It's bullshit. It's bullshit.
No, I think it'd be cool.
And ball shark.
So we did get a couple over on Instagram. Our first one is from Let's Talk Horror Channel, good friend BP, who said, I'll always have strong opinions on this, but it is a film that will live in the shadow of the OG, but deserves to be recognized for what it is. A full-on horror with amazing scenes, and Arlie Ermey gives a great performance. And the film is one of the most aesthetically gorgeous films out there with some amazing shots. I could go on, but I won't, but I have always loved this movie. Oh, yeah, and the other one was just from you guys, so I don't need to read.
What do we say?
Well, you said you hadn't seen this in 20 years, so
yeah.
There we go. All right, well, that is about it, guys. So before we go, though, share with us where we can find you, what your show is all about, and share with the world.
Charlie,
yeah,
get it, Charlie.
Oh, yeah. This is all me now. Okay. Yeah.
You're damn right.
Hey, we are Give Me Back My Action and Horror Movies. We are a weekly podcast that alternates each week talking about action and horror movies, mostly from the VHS era, but we do throw in some newer stuff. You know, heck, the 2020s or the 2000s are 20 years ago, so those are old, and VHSs came out then too. So we have a lot of fun over there doing that. If you want to find us, we are on Spotify, Apple, all the podcatchers that are out there, and social medias, which is where we found our friends here at Dissect That Film. We are on Facebook at Give Me Back My Action, the Facebook group. Give Me Back My Horror Movies, the Facebook group. Both of us are on Instagram. We're on X. We're on Threads. We're on TikTok. All the places, all the fun shit. So that's where you can find us, and that's what we do.
Thank you all for being here. It was a blast.
Thank you.
This is
good time.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm glad this finally got to happen.
Thank you guys for coming.
Let's do this again.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. You guys are awesome. As I said before, I love your show. I listen to your show every week. And you guys have such a great rapport, and you guys bounce off each other so well, even with the, you know, I love the like we got to see here. You guys kind of going after each other. It's always a good time. And we have a lot of fun, and it was great to.
It's easy to pick on Nate. There's so much to pick on. Now.
I don't know why I'm the one getting picked on. I'm innocent.
Because Charlie's bigger than both of us.
This is true.
See, scurry. Yeah.
And I know where you both live, so you know that.
Before we go into our socials and all that fun stuff, next we're going to talk a little bit about next week. Next week, which is not, you're getting an episode early. We usually release on Fridays, but you're going to be getting an episode on Halloween Day.
Whoa!
We are going to be going through the entire Halloween franchise, talking about each one, and ranking them to have our definitive Dissect That Film Halloween franchise ranking. We did it with Friday the
Sons of Bitches.
We did it with Friday the 13th, and so now since Halloween is celebrating 45 years, we got a lot of those movies are celebrating big anniversaries this year. We said, fuck it, we're gonna watch all 13 Halloween movies, and we're gonna rank them all, and then we're gonna have a definitive ranking.
You have to revisit Ends.
Yes, I am rewatching every single one of them because I want to know what they're like now as an adult. Because some of them I have not seen since I was a kid, so I got to revisit them to see.
H2O since I was a kid,
well, like 4 and 5, it's been a long time. I did the last time I watched those was like on the when AMC would always show them for like Fear Fest.
Yeah, that was the only ones they would show.
Yeah,
legit.
Yeah. So yeah, it's been an adventure. And some of them have been doozies, and I can't wait to go through them and rank them and get to talk about them because that Friday the 13th episode was a lot of fun. And it's something different. It's something different from our normal show. So, yeah, so you're going to be getting an early episode on Halloween Day. It's very exciting. And so that means that Friday you're going to be getting a live show like we do at the end of every month. So at least you will be getting something on Friday instead of a new episode. But you can find Dissect That Film on all the social medias, of course. You can find us at Dissect That Film on all the podcast apps, on YouTube. Wherever you type in Dissect That Film, you're probably going to find us on something.
I'm working on an X video account.
Yes. Pornhub, you know, all those things.
Yeah, we're going to make it happen.
or you could just go to any one of our social media. Or you could just go to our link tree in any one of our socials bios, and we have all the links you need. And all of the links for Dan and Angela and myself, our personal links are down in the description. All the links for Let's Give Me Back My Horror Movies / Action Movies will be down in the description as well. So you can find everything down below. And yeah, that's going to be it for us, everybody. It's been a long one, but it's been a fun one. So until next time, I forgot to thank. We have a Patreon, guys.
Oh, shit. Say,
we have a Patreon. What? I always fucking do this shit. We have a Patreon. And guess what? There's a change now. We have two tiers. We have a $1 tier where you get episodes early. We have now, I am dropping the price on our $5 tier down to $3 for the rest of the year. So if you want to join on the Patreon, it is now $3 and you get extra shows. We have a monster show where we spin a wheel every month. We talk about monster movies. It's really fun. It's called The Monster Zone. Dan and Angela hosts that one. And then we also have a Tubi show that we sometimes do, but we're going to do it now that we drop that price down because we want people to join the Patreon. So patreon.com/dissectthatfilm. And thank you to all the people who are patrons right now. You're amazing, and thank you for the support. And now I can end the show.
Hang on.
What?
You want to know what's on Monster Zone this month?
No.
No.
They'll figure it out. But until
we gotta help you out.
I can never end the show, you know, smoothly, all right? So let's go. Until next time, I am Brett Parker. That is Dan and Angela of DNA Gaming, and that is Nate, Pete, and Charlie of Give Me Back My Horror / Action Movies. See y'all again next time. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Love you.
Bye.